On to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 1669 in the name of Fergus Ewing on securing the interests of Scotland's rural economy following the EU referendum. And can I ask all members who wish to speak in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Fergus Ewing to speak to and move the motion in his name.
Presiding Officer, I believe that the risks of leaving the European Union are just too great. All the economic experts predict that the potential damage a Brexit would do to jobs, mortgages, and the economy as a whole across Scotland is just too severe. Presiding Officer, these are not my words, but those of David Mundell, and I could not agree more. In June, Mr. Mundell and many Scottish Tories agreed with this government and others in this Parliament that the best way to protect the interests of rural Scotland was by protecting Scotland's place in Europe. Yet now, these same Tories are preparing to give away the significant economic and social benefits that EU membership provides for Scotland's rural economy, benefits worth billions of pounds between 2014 and 2020. This is not a price that rural Scotland should have to pay. The UK government has removed the security from future EU funding, risking our economic prosperity in the ways that I will set out today. Yet not one Scottish Tory politician, post 23rd of June, has dared to point out to their London bosses the blindingly obvious risks to Scotland's rural and coastal communities that this failure to guarantee future funding represents. Worse, they all appear to have become born-again Brexiteers. Presiding Officer, I want to put on record my appreciation for the EU funding guarantee provided by the UK government to date, giving farmers and crofters certainty about their direct support. Their Pillar 1 support up to 2020 is a huge relief. The partial guarantee for Scottish Rural Development Programme and European Maritime and Fisheries Fund grants in respect of those grants signed and sealed by the Chancellor's autumn statement also helps. I make those two statements to put on record. I welcome for those measures, but just as important is the additional guarantee provided by our own Cabinet Secretary for Finance to pass on all of that direct support in full. That is the sort of clarity and certainty which builds confidence. What Scotland now needs is the rest of its entitlement, around £360 million in SRDP and EMFF monies, is not yet guaranteed, the loss of which will have real-life consequences for our rural economy. And let me spell out what that failure to provide this funding could mean. Yeah. 40 fewer businesses receiving investment through the Food Processing, Marketing and Cooperation Scheme, 20,000 fewer hectares supported for afforestation and woodland creation, and potentially up to 40 million fewer trees planted through the Forestry Grant Scheme. 88 fewer holdings supported through the new entrance schemes for farming. Farmers and crofters entitled to LFAS payments on average receiving around 12,400 less overall between now and 2020. But as well as threatening vital funding for key rural development, Brexit has paralysed the UK minister's willingness and ability to address everyday policy matters. First, they have failed to respond to Scotland's case for devolution of £190 million of cap convergence uplift money. Second, they have refused to progress repatriation of 1.5 million of red meat levy monies. Third, they have refused to move on making similar changes to the sea fish levy. And fourth, they have failed to play fair by Scotland's dairy farmers in allocating the recent EU emergency support package. And moreover, excessive delay on other matters has become the norm. For example, a swap on monkfish quota took 3 months to conclude when it should only have taken 3 days. And DEFRA is still sitting on the Fisheries Concordat, a cornerstone of domestic fisheries policy, failing to put in place this vital agreement that allows us to manage our fisheries more effectively. Presiding Officer, Scottish fishermen are used to being treated unfairly by the UK government. And other speakers in this debate will elaborate on this. But I intend to work to get the best deal for our fishing and coastal communities. It's therefore essential that Scotland is not only involved fully in all UK negotiations regarding our future in Europe, but also in all decision-making, including on future fisheries management. But the best way to protect the interests of Scotland's rural economy is by maintaining membership of and access to the single market and its 500 million people. The threat of a hard Brexit is undermining confidence in all rural sectors. 40% of food and drink companies participating in the Bank of Scotland's annual research said that leaving the EU was the biggest challenge facing the sector. And almost a third of SMEs recently surveyed in the Highlands said the outcome of the referendum on the EU made investing in their business less likely or subject to delay. This uncertainty, presiding officer, made entirely in Westminster, risks the forestry sector's £1 billion annual economic contribution because investment decisions in planting and processing require long-term stability and confidence. In food production, the potential loss of protection through EU regulations vital to continue exports risks, for example, our world-leading seed potato sector worth £100 million to Scotland. The EU represents the largest food export market for Scottish fish and seafood with £438 million, or 62% of total food exports being to the EU. Europe is the biggest market for our world-famous salmon, and the Scotch Whisky Association has called on the UK government for clarity to be provided regarding trade arrangements as soon as possible. Presiding officer, the risks to these resources are very real, but they are not perhaps the most potent threat to rural Scotland's prosperity. That exists to our most precious of all resources, namely our people. Each bottle of whisky sold, every tree planted, each fish landed, every acre ploughed and sown, every food product designed and invented, every breakthrough in animal welfare or plant health requires people. The lack of clarity about Scotland's future in Europe means uncertainty for Scots and for UK citizens now living in rural Scotland. The biggest risk is to those whom we have welcomed from across the water into communities all round rural and coastal Scotland and upon whom many businesses and communities depend. The right of people from other EU countries to continue to live and work in Scotland is not only a moral imperative, which it is, born of our commitment to solidarity, but also an economic necessity for rural Scotland. At risk without continued free movement of people are many of the 15,000 seasonal workers in agriculture, 30,000 permanent workers in food and drink, a fair proportion of the 25,000 jobs in forestry, 8% of people employed by our fishing fleet, and many of the thousands working in food and in tourism, in hotels, bars, and restaurants all around Scotland. Without these people, Scotland's rural economy simply wouldn't work. Meanwhile, seasonal employers are already worrying about prospects for next year. One agency, about which I heard last week, advised that the number of Europeans signing onto its books has dropped. There is no doubt. Yes, of course.
You said earlier that David Mundell asked the question, what would happen to the families who rely on jobs for their livelihoods linked to membership of the EU? Does the Cabinet Secretary know if the UK government can now answer that question?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as with so many other areas, we are simply none the wiser. I mean, this is a debate. So, you know, I'm very happy to hear whether the Scottish Conservatives are in favour of continued free movement of people, are in favour of continued membership of the free market and continued trade with the free market. But I fear, I have a suspicion, and I hope I'm wrong, Presiding Officer, that the chances of getting simplicity, clarity and straightforward answers from our friends in the Conservative benches today are rather similar to those of Ed Balls being asked and invited to join the Bolshoi Ballet.
Dean Lockhart. Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. There seems to be some confusion on this side of the chamber. The question is not membership or not of the single market. It's not a binary proposition. The question is what level of access we will get to the single market and the terms upon which that access is negotiated. It is a matter of negotiation.
Yes, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, that was about as clear as mud, wasn't it? I don't know whether it was in binary or some other system, but I can tell you this. We're in favour of free movement. We're in favour of continued membership of the common market free trade arrangements. But we do not know. We simply do not have a clue what the UK government's position is. But perhaps this debate will be an opportunity for Conservatives to dispel that confusion. Presiding officer, there's no doubt that we do, therefore, face clear and present dangers. They are here, and we can't just ignore them. Mm-hmm. I've spelt out the numbers. They are truly frightening. But unlike the UK government, which is neglecting its day job, I'm getting on with mine. Mm-hmm. Presiding officer, this government is not prepared to wait for decisions to be made about Scotland's future. We are getting on with making Scotland's future. I am utterly focused on driving forward the rural economy, doing all I can to inject confidence, consistency and certainty, as well as cash, and sending a strong message that Scotland, that rural Scotland is and will remain open for business. We are on track to meet our ambitious broadband targets, providing vital 21st century infrastructure to support the rural economy. In last year, we've approved over £26 million worth of grants for forestry development, a matter of some jocularity apparently to Conservatives, but something which those receiving them much appreciate. We are investing £20 million through SRDP in a new farm advisory service. We've invested £11 million in businesses, services and infrastructure in fishing, fish processing and aquaculture. 2 weeks ago, I announced a national loan scheme worth up to £300 million for farmers and crofters, injecting a huge stimulus into the rural economy this winter, welcomed by just about everybody in an unqualified fashion, apart from the Conservatives. Next year, we will launch a national rural infrastructure plan to maximise the impact of investment and resources in rural communities. We will work with our partners to develop the National Food and Drink Hub, and I'm hosting a series of summits with key rural and coastal businesses around the country with Mr. Russell on shellfish back on Friday last week near Moffat on forestry to learn from their views and to learn how best we grow the rural economy working with industry, academe and government together. Two things give me hope. First, the resilience, ingenuity, motivation and entrepreneurship of our people. And second, my belief that no government, not even the UK government, presiding officer, would be so reckless, so dilatory in their responsibilities, so ignorant of the threats facing the real rural world, that they would fail to acknowledge the importance of access to markets worth £438 million for fishing and invaluable to our farmers and free movement of people. So the UK government must now, as we all do, recognise that the best way to protect our rural interests is by protecting Scotland's place in Europe, maintaining membership of the single market and access to the free movement of labour. I will continue to press UK ministers, and I've written to them several times without substantive answer on any of the major points I've raised today. I will continue to press them to do their job, to engage with us constructively, and I hope that we, as Scotland's Parliament, can resolve to do all we can to secure the jobs, the businesses, the investment and development dependent upon the economic and social benefits which the EU membership provides. I would say that we've had constructive discussions with the Greens about the terms and the wording of our motion, and we have also had those with Labour colleagues, and we will be accepting their amendment. In conclusion, presiding officer, we all want to do our best by those in rural Scotland. For that, we need to continue to have our positive relationship with our good friends in Europe, and we need to have the continued goodwill of all of those EU citizens who give their life, their effort, and their commitment to our country.
And I call on Peter Chapman to speak to and move the amendment in his name.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I refer members to my register of interests in regard to farming. I note Fergus Ewing is still preaching doom and gloom today, and he's still preaching division between Scotland and the UK government. Presiding officer, the Scottish Government have taken a courageous decision in holding this debate today, a courageous decision because their record on looking after our rural economy is simply abysmal. I think it is fair to say that the whole chamber is aware of the litany of failures that this government has been responsible for over the last decade when it comes to our rural economy. The Scottish Government has allowed this to happen because instead of focusing on running the country, they have been and still are obsessed by the idea of another independence referendum. I suppose we shouldn't be surprised when, in the words of the First Minister, independence transcends everything else. She said, and I quote, that the case for full self-government ultimately transcends the issues of Brexit, of oil, of national wealth and balance sheets. Presiding officer, that is a shocking statement. It would shock unemployed oil workers in the North East. It would shock all those waiting to hear what this government will do to make the best of Brexit. It is a final admission that the SNP aren't interested in running the country, only in rerunning the independence referendum. While Scottish government ministers are talking up the press prospect of another divisive referendum, what they should be doing is speaking up for all those who contribute to our rural economy. Those hard-working farmers, crofters and fishermen deserve better. Back in June, I voted Remain. I thought it offered the best way forward for both Scotland and the UK. But unlike this SNP government, I have accepted the democratic will of the people. A clear majority across the UK voted to leave, and leave we must. Having said that, I also recognise that many opportunities exist from the EU referendum result. Opportunities that, if we embrace them enthusiastically, could reinvigorate our rural economy. From the highest hills down through our fertile lowlands to coastal towns, there is a path that we can take to strengthen our rural communities for the long term. I don't think anyone that I have met in farming or fishing circles would claim that the EU is perfect. I certainly have never thought that. The EU is bureaucratic, undemocratic, and bogged down by red tape and a currency which is proving to be disastrous for poorer Mediterranean countries like Greece, Spain, and Italy.
Would the member take an intervention?
Absolutely.
Stuart Stevenson.
Does the member think that a country where more than half of its legislators are unelected, appointed for life, and undismissible is democratic? I, of course, refer to the House of Lords in the UK.
Peter Chapman.
That is a democracy that we have until we change it. We don't know. You're speaking about uncertainty. Uncertainty, there has been much talk of uncertainty following Brexit. But there would also have been great uncertainty for farmers, fishermen and crofters if we had remained in the EU. We don't know, and we won't know for some time, what the next CAP system will look like. But what we do know is that year in, year out, CAP payments for farmers have been falling. Budgets are tight in the EU as well as here, and I am certain that less money will be available for European farmers in the future. Brexit offers an opportunity for the Scottish Government to reshape the way they support rural communities. It must be possible to design a better support system targeted at Scottish farmers and our unique problems, rather than trying to accommodate 28 countries covering all of Europe from the Arctic Circle to the Mediterranean Sea.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, in that regard, could Mr. Chapman answer me this? When David Cameron said that Brexit, quotes, would punish farmers, was he wrong?
Peter Chapman.
That remains to be seen. There's a negotiation to be done. If we get behind it, if you folks get behind it, of course there is a great opportunity ahead. But it requires the Scottish Government to get behind the system as well. It must be possible to design a better system. It must be. As NFU Scotland have pointed out, there is a real prize to be had from developing a new subsidy system. Nobody's saying it'll be easy. It will be difficult to get a support system tailored to Scotland's needs. The question is this: will the SNP put in the legwork? Will they sit down with the industry? Will they sit down with farmers across Scotland who can see this opportunity? Will they sit down with the UK government? Instead of banging on about the constitution, they should get on with the business of governing. Of course, it's not just farmers who need the Scottish Government on their side. Fishermen across Scotland, particularly those in my parts of the North East, voted almost to a man to leave. Not so long ago, they would have trusted the SNP to speak up for them. They would have heard the comments of Alex Salmond, who back in 2004 described the common fisheries policy as disastrous for Scotland's fishing communities. And they would have felt that the SNP understood their concerns over, quote, Brussels mismanagement. They may even have cheered when Mike Russell was appointed to Nicola Sturgeon's cabinet with responsibility for Brexit, as he had previously co-authored a book, Grasping the Thistle, where he said that trade and not political integration should be our relationship with Europe. The fervour with which Nicola Sturgeon has attempted to deny the political and legal reality around the EU result, claiming that Scotland could stay in, shows a breathtaking contempt for fishing communities and a breathtaking lack of understanding of the real world. As former Cabinet Secretary Alex Neil has said, the EU has already made it clear that there will not be separate negotiations with Scotland until after the UK-EU Brexit deal is done. When will the Scottish Government face up to the reality of our situation? If the Scottish Government were listening, they would have heard the Scottish Fishing Federation's views on this historic result. They would know that fishermen view this as a choice, as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. They would know that fishermen value the chance to reinvigorate its coastal and island communities. They would know that fishermen see huge potential in getting back control of their waters. No, I've done enough. They would know the huge prize in setting the rules in some of the richest fishing grounds in the world. That said, we can't allow our vital fishing industry to be used as a bargaining chip in Brexit negotiations. And I'm glad to say that some in the SNP do see this opportunity. Councillor John Cox, an SNP councillor, has recognised the opportunity for North East fishing from Brexit and has spoken out. Now, colleagues across the chamber will have seen this welcome headline today in the Times. And here's a German business chief saying that Brexit will boost Britain. That's a welcome headline today. And when partners and allies on the other side of the channel see the opportunities that we have, why can't this government? Why must it be so determined to make a failure of Brexit? I hope the Scottish Government gets behind Scottish fishing before it is too late. Presiding officer, this is a government that is attempting to distract from the record of incompetence by issuing furious press releases about the Constitution. Why is that? It's because the Scottish Government doesn't have a plan to improve our rural communities. It isn't listening to the industry leaders when it comes to Brexit. It isn't listening to farmers, fishermen and everyone else who makes up rural communities on lack of services. It isn't listening to hard-working doctors in remote towns who are being let down by the government's inability to get more staff in place. It isn't listening to furious council taxpayers in the north-east of Scotland who will pay £47 million extra in council tax, only to see tens of millions of that disappear into the central belt. And that's because the SNP government have turned their back on rural Scotland. They have taken rural communities for granted for nearly a decade, and they simply aren't interested if you don't live in the central belt. When it comes to the CAP IT system, the SNP wasted millions of pounds on a system that still can't deliver, a system that has starved farmers of money, rightfully theirs and desperately needed, a system that means 40 million of last year's money is still outstanding 9 months on. When we see record levels of debt for Scottish farmers, the SNP don't have a clue what to do. Folks across Scotland, whether they be industry leaders, individual farmers or skippers, can see the potential from Brexit. They know that a better government would seek to work positively and constructively with the industry, with key stakeholders and with the UK government so that we can all get the best deal possible. A better government would be big enough to listen. A better government would be focused on creating a strong Scotland, not organising another unwanted referendum. Rural Scotland needs a better government, and the SNP has a great opportunity to deliver it. The question is this: have they the ability, have they the talent and the will to deliver it? My colleagues and I will fight for that new type of government every day so that our rural economy can have the leadership it deserves and the future that we believe we can achieve. I move the amendment in my name.
I call on Rhoda Grant to speak to and move the amendment in her name.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We in the Scottish Labour Party have supported the Scottish Government's stance to get the best deal for Scotland from Brexit. Ideally, that would mean respecting both mandates delivered by the Scottish people to remain part of the UK and remain in the EU, to forge strong alliances, sharing resources and knowledge. The decision to leave the EU will damage the rural economy. We have seen how Europe deals with peripherality, seeking to remove barriers and create fairer trading conditions. And this is something governments in the UK and Scotland have not done, and neither have they appeared to learn the need for this from Europe. I cover the Highlands and Islands region, a region that has benefited hugely from European assistance. We built roads, causeways, provided training and support for communities. We benefited from CAP payments and rural development funding. The loss of these things will undoubtedly hit rural Scotland hardest. We have seen, as a response to austerity, the centralisation of resources, pulling jobs and investment from rural areas and concentrating them in urban areas. And this doesn't augur well, as Brexit will undoubtedly lead to fewer resources, and this will disproportionately impact on rural areas by causing greater centralisation. If rural Scotland is to be protected, we need to embrace policies that deal with peripherality, recognising that to do business and provide services will always cost more in rural area. Transport challenges cause problems, as do the lack of economies of scale. Both governments need to ensure that rural Scotland does not disproportionately bear the brunt of Brexit. Presiding Officer, can I firstly turn to our amendment with regard to broadband? A huge amount of work is happening at European level to ensure access to broadband. It's no longer a luxury, but a necessity. We've already had European regional development funding for our broadband rollout, but much more will come in the future, again targeted at the areas that have most to benefit but suffer market failure. The areas where the market fails are in rural Scotland, but also in urban areas of deprivation, parts of the country that seem always to be at the back of the queue. And I note that the Carnegie Trust have published a research paper, Digital Participation and Social Justice in Scotland, making exactly those points quite starkly. And I was reading that earlier today. Applications for welfare payments are now made online, and the Employment Department looks for electronic job applications as proof of job seeking. To do this, you must be online, and it makes it difficult for those without access to broadband to comply, leading to benefit sanctions. And it also makes it more difficult for them to seek work in the first place. These areas also lose out with access to health and public services. Access to broadband would allow these services to be delivered to them much closer to home. We need to provide these services for all our populations, something that will be difficult to do without the help of our European neighbours. We have to note the impact of the EU on roaming charges, something that we will all see the benefit of, as big mobile phone operators will have to charge reasonable amounts for roaming. That is something we stand to lose with exit from the EU and something we need to fight to keep. I welcome the UK government's commitment to protect cap direct payments until 2020, the Scottish Government's decision to pass this on in full to farmers and crofters, and it'll give them some comfort. However, we need to look further into the future. Yep. We know that working the land is not a year-on-year business. It can't easily adapt to change. Land use can sometimes take years to change. We need to use this breathing space to look at our policy for farming going forward, post-2020. Many say that cap payments will be unaffordable in the future, and we need to see if this is the case. And if it is, we need to start working with farmers and crofters right now, helping them to build secure and prosperous businesses for the future. When we look at the system that will succeed cap payments, we also need to reevaluate the relationship between farming subsidies and making sure that everyone in Scotland has access to cheap and nutritious food. Therefore, the government's legislation on food is required sooner rather than later. We already have families dependent on food banks, and if food becomes more expensive, it'll have a knock-on effect and indeed impact on the nutrition and health of the nation. This is not just about farmers and crofters, it's about much wider society. There are also rural payments such as the SRDP, which have not had the same guarantees placed on them by either government. I heard at the weekend that the LEADER programme is closing to new applications. And this was in the context of rural transport, where communities were looking to build their own transport solutions due to market failure. This is devastating to rural communities who need to provide essential services and develop community responses to rurality. Given the amount of economic benefit that flows from LEADER, we need to try and find a way of replicating it, guaranteeing funding going forward and ensuring that our rural communities do not lose out. This is... Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Rhoda Grant for giving way. Does the Labour Party believe, as we do, that the most helpful thing to end this uncertainty about LEADER and other programmes under the SRDP is if the UK government were to confirm that the planned investment under the SRDP of the EU will be met in full by the UK government?
Rhoda Grant.
Yes, I think we need that sooner rather than later, because funding streams are already closing off 2 years ahead of any proposed Brexit. And this means that those 2 years, we will lose the benefits that would flow from that. So I think it's very important to give a degree of stability to those depending on that funding, because it will get much worse if we don't do that, and we will lose out in services to our rural communities. Can I turn quickly to fishing as well? And we know that the fishing community were keen on Brexit, and I hope they won't be disappointed, but I fear they will. I think we all appreciate that annual fishery negotiations left a lot to be desired, and they seem to be more about exhaustion that led to agreement rather than good management. But that said, negotiations with Norway and the Faroes actually make CFP negotiations look fantastic, and we don't want to have those types of brinkmanship negotiations happening for the whole of Europe too. We stand to lose access to EU funding, both for the European Maritime Fisheries Fund, but also for scientific funding. Our fishing community has been at the forefront of developing new technology and providing more focused fisheries and minimising bycatch. And we don't want to lose those advantages. And neither do we want to see vast differences in regulation because of Brexit. We're going to have to negotiate with the rest of the EU besides, and there are many pitfalls in that, so our fishing industry can't expect an end to red tape straight away, indeed, if they can in the future. Presiding officer, we all know we have much to lose from Brexit, and that's why the majority of those in the chamber campaigned against it, something that brought a different vote in Scotland. However, we're facing it, and it's incumbent on all of us to get the best outcome for Scotland and indeed for the UK. We want the Scottish Government to be part of these negotiations, but that means they need to work as part of the UK. It's not simply good enough to use this as a platform to promote their own ambitions of independence. We need both our governments working together to protect the Scottish interest. Nothing less will be acceptable to Scotland and the UK, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. We now enter the open debate. I call Richard Lockhead, followed by Dean Lockhart. Richard Lockhead.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Clearly, the outcome of the Brexit debate will have profound consequences for rural Scotland, and anyone like me who has taken a close interest in the relationship between the European Union and rural Scotland for many years must start by acknowledging that due to the deep flaws in the Common Fisheries Policy and indeed the Common Agricultural Policy, it is of course quite understandable that many people believe that Brexit offers an opportunity to leave those policies behind them, even though I believe it's not the interests of all of Scotland to leave the EU. And of course, I've spoken to not that many farmers that voted to remain, and we all know that many people in the catching sector of the fishing industry voted to leave the EU as well. So it's absolutely essential that we listen to their reasons and fully respect their informed views. We know the EU's agricultural policy is clearly flawed because farm incomes declined despite billions of pounds of public investment being pumped into that sector. And we know the Common Fisheries Policy fails miserably sometimes to respond quickly enough to industry concerns and the biology overseas. But there is no doubt in my mind that leaving the EU, compounded by the Tory government's apparent enthusiasm for a hard Brexit, is likely to bring turmoil for all of Scotland's economy, and particularly our rural economy, should that come to pass. Yes, rural Scotland will adapt to the post-Brexit world, but that will take years. And in the meantime, our communities will pay a really heavy price because our economy will fall a long way before it begins to climb back. And that means that jobs and incomes will be hit hard for many, and many businesses will suffer, and many families will suffer in rural, coastal Scotland, and indeed across the whole of the country. Now, I hear that Brexit Tories keep telling us it will be all right on the night. Our farmers are promised milk and honey, and our fishermen calm seas ahead once we get control of our waters back into our own hands here in the UK and Scotland. But like most things in life, it's not quite as simple as that. Firstly, our primary producers need markets for their products, for our magnificent seafood and for our lamb and so on. But the focus of the Brexit debate so far in Scotland, and indeed the UK in particular, has been about maintaining access to our membership of the single market. What we absolutely have to focus on is the implications for rural Scotland of departing the customs union. That's what we need to hear more about and be more concerned about in this Parliament. The Prime Minister may be talking about ways of maintaining a deep trading relationship with the EU post-Brexit, but she has effectively ruled out maintaining the customs union with the EU by setting up the Department for International Trade under Liam Fox, which has got the specific aim of finding new markets. Now, as I understand it, members of the customs union can't go off and negotiate their own free trade agreements with the rest of the world. So it seems the Tories are now spiralling towards a hard Brexit and preparing to walk away from the customs union. And a hard Brexit and departure from the customs union spells costs, bureaucracy for our rural industries. Every nut and bolt or langoustine or craft beer exported to the EU will have to be the subject of new trade negotiations.
Please, Mr. Donald.
I appreciate the importance of the points you make, but does he not accept that it is possible, and indeed it is the status quo, for countries to be members of the single market without being members of the customs union? And I quote Norway as an obvious example.
Well, you're either in the customs union or you're out it. If Scotland is taken out of the customs union against our will, this will have enormous consequences for Scotland's exporters, particularly our food and drink exporters and our primary products. Of course, this is a debate about rural Scotland, and these economies are very important to rural communities. I'm also very concerned about the UK's track record of broken promises to many of our rural sectors in light of all these promises that have been made at the moment. Dean Lockhart, Mr Chapman, I think it was actually, said that there's a danger that fishing will be used as a bargaining chip. The only minister that's been in the news recently who has said that it's possible fishing in the UK could be used as a bargaining chip is the UK Conservative Minister George Eustace. So not only did the Conservatives betray our fishing communities when they took us into the CFP back in the 70s, it looks like now they're lining up to betray our fishing communities again, and this time when they actually tried to get us out of the CFP and out of Europe. So, you know, the Scottish Tory Party have to ensure the UK Tory Party do not betray our fishing communities once again. We're also promised that Brexit will... Just want to move on. We're also promised that Brexit will enhance the powers of the Scottish Parliament. Yet, as we heard from Fergus Ewing in his opening remarks, there's more powers over many of our rural industries that could be devolved to the Scottish Parliament at the moment. But the UK government take the decision not to do that. And then let's look at the post-Brexit scenario should that happen. Let's look at the supposed powers that would come back to Scotland. First of all, we hear a lot about fisheries policy. Now, at the moment, fisheries policy is supposed to devolve to the Scottish Parliament, but the fortunes of our fishing communities are decided through international negotiations. The UK government conveniently deems international negotiations as a reserved issue because it's foreign affairs. That will continue post-Brexit. So the fortunes of our fishing communities that are largely dependent on the outcome of these international negotiations will still remain a reserved issue post-Brexit unless the UK government are going to devolve foreign affairs, which I think is unlikely, to the Scottish government. There's also the issue of funding, which Fergus Ewing quite rightly has highlighted, and the fact that Brexit will mean the responsibility for funding many of the rural industries will pass from Brussels and the European Union to the UK Treasury in London. The UK Treasury in London's policy is to reduce funding for our rural industries, particularly direct farming for agricultural communities. Therefore, Brexit means that the shield that's protected many of our rural communities up to now through EU membership, with the UK is outvoted by other countries, that shield will be shattered and our rural communities will be exposed to decisions taken by the UK Treasury in London. And that is a major threat to our rural industries. Food and drink, of course, is growing at double the UK average, which rather responds to the point from Mr Chapman that the Scottish Government are not protecting rural communities. We're growing at double the average of the UK sector. And issues like protected geographical indication, which is protected food names, very important to Scottish food and drink products. What's going to happen to that protection that's been built up over many, many years if we're out of the customs union and out of the single market and out of Europe? That is a real concern for many of the food and drink producers in Scotland at the moment. And there's about £700 million worth of exports in salmon and some of our other major PGI products at the moment. So this is why maintaining our ongoing relationship is absolutely essential for Scotland's rural communities. And I wish our ministers all the best in ensuring the wishes of rural Scotland and the whole of Scotland are respected going forward, and it would maintain our relationship with Europe to protect the interests of Scotland's rural communities.
Dean Lockhart, to be followed by Emma Harper. Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mr Lockhart talks about further powers being transferred to this Parliament. We're still waiting to see how the SNP will use their existing powers, so we wait with bated breath. In our amendment to the government motion, we have stressed the importance of securing jobs, incomes, businesses, investment and development in rural Scotland itself. And that's why we, on this side of the chamber, will continue to focus on the opportunities available to the rural economy going forward and not share in the gloom and doom of the SNP. As Peter Chapman has already made clear, there will be challenges arising from Brexit and we will have to address those challenges. But this government's past and ongoing rural economic policy has been far more damaging to the rural economy than any potential impact of Brexit. For example, back in 2008, the OECD published a review of rural policy in Scotland, and amongst its key findings were that the rural economy in Scotland suffered from, and I quote, centralisation and a lack of local participation in rural policy making, and also suffered from weak integration of rural, regional and sector policies. Unfortunately, Presiding Officer, rural economic policy in Scotland has not progressed a great deal in the 8 years since that report. According to an Audit Scotland report published in July, a couple of months ago, this government's economic and development policy, and again I quote, is a broad, high-level strategy that does not set out in detail how underpinning policies and initiatives will be implemented. Presiding Officer, with no coherent economic or development planning or implementation in place, it's no surprise that the rural economy has suffered over the last 10 years. Further examples of bad policy are set out in the Audit Scotland report, which notes that the government has identified seven growth sectors in the Scottish economy, including two sectors that are vital for the rural economy, that's sustainable tourism and food and drink. However, Audit Scotland goes on to say these growth sectors have now been prioritised by the government for 9 years, but the Scottish government has not carried out an assessment of what has been achieved as a result of this support. In other words, after almost a decade in power, the government has not reviewed the results of an economic policy introduced 10 years ago. It's clear, this is clear economic mismanagement, and it means that the current and changing needs of rural Scotland are not being met. Yes, yes, please.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, let's take food and drink. You just heard Mr. Lockhead say that the growth of food and drink has been twice that of England. I would say that in itself is a measure of success, and everybody in the sector says so. In sustainable tourism, I was tourism minister for 5 years, and the sector is doing extremely well. Everybody says that. Does Mr. Carson not realise that?
Mr. Ewing, I would suggest that success is despite and not because of government policy. Let me just conclude that Audit Scotland also highlighted the widespread confusion over the full range of public sector support and funding available to business in rural Scotland. Audit Scotland highlights that public sector support is not well understood. It goes on to state that the financial support available to the rural community is unnecessarily complex, a clear indication that business in rural Scotland is not getting the financial support that it needs. It's interesting that Mr. Ewing mentions the food and drink sector. That's an area of opportunity that I'll come on to. So, Presiding Officer, I highlight these issues today because they demonstrate that there are urgent issues that need to be addressed in rural Scotland, and it's within the powers of this government to address these issues. They are independent of Brexit, and it is within the power of this government to address these issues. Let me move on to the opportunities, because it covers some of the sectors mentioned by Mr. Ewing. Going forward, the best way of securing jobs and developing business in rural Scotland is for the government to take action we've been highlighting to develop those sectors of the rural economy that can benefit from Brexit and not just keep relying on subsidies coming from the EU. By way of example, Mr. Ewing, you mentioned sustainable tourism and food and drink. Look at food and drink. The largest exporter in this sector, as you know, is Scotch whisky. Now, Scotch, we met with representatives of the SWA at the Economy Committee today, and they told us that there are significant opportunities going forward to increase exports of Scotch whisky. One example was in South America, where there is massively increasing demand, but there is only one office of Scottish Development International covering the whole of South America. So I look forward to hearing during the course of today, what actions the government will take to exploit these opportunities. Sure.
Stuart Stevenson.
I'm interested in what the member says. I wonder if he can advise us how many embassies or consulates of the UK have had events for Scotch whisky for which they have not charged a commercial rate.
Dean Lockhart.
Well, that's a very specific question. I don't have that information to hand, as I'm sure you would expect. Presiding Officer, let me conclude by highlighting that this government must change its policies towards the rural economy. First of all, the government's lack of detail in economic policy, the confusion over financial support made available to the rural business community needs to be clarified. As highlighted by Audit Scotland, the latest example of unclear policy was the Scottish Government's announcement of the Scottish Growth Scheme, announced 2 weeks ago, a policy that has caused confusion not only in the rural business community but across the business community in Scotland. I'll conclude now, Presiding Officer. There is much the SNP can do now to support the economy in rural Scotland. First, it has to stop scaremongering over Brexit, and then it must seize the opportunities that we and leading business organisations are highlighting. However, it is becoming increasingly clear that after almost a decade in power, this is a government lacking in vision, running out of ideas, it's got no new policies, and a government unable to deal with new challenges and unable to grasp the very real opportunities that lie ahead.
Emma Harper, followed by Lewis MacDonald. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to speak in this important debate about how we can best secure the interests of Scotland's rural economy following the EU referendum. I represent South Scotland, where farming and food and drink, two of the sectors most likely to be impacted by Tory Brexit, play a vital role in providing employment and maintaining economic stability. Dumfries and Galloway has nearly a quarter of Scotland's kye, more than any other region in Scotland, and 16% of Scotland's sheep, just behind Galloway's neighbour, the Borders. Dumfries and Galloway is one of Scotland's top food-producing regions. The food and drink sector generates over £500 million of turnover annually and employs over 9,000 people. It has long been one of D&G's greatest strengths. The implications of this Tory Brexit are therefore potentially huge. 69% of Scotland's overseas food and exports go to the EU. A third of Scotch whisky exports go to the EU, and 68% of Scottish seafood exports go to the EU. Scotland's food and drink is worth £14 billion a year to the Scottish economy. So leaving the European Union will increase costs to businesses and reduce access to markets. The 60 EU free trade agreements... Yes.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Mr. Harper, for taking the intervention. The Bank of Scotland survey summarised that despite current uncertainty, Scotland's food and drink sector is remarkably more confident compared with 12 months ago. 82% predict an increase or a change in jobs forecast following the EU referendum. I just wondered if Emma Harper felt that the Scottish food and drink industry were actually uncertain by the EU referendum or positive.
Emma Harper.
Thanks for that intervention. Brexit hasn't actually happened yet. Indeed. I think that's something that everybody really needs to pay attention to. The Bank of Scotland are continuing to look at information. Next year they're predicting that we'll have more, but it depends on what happens in the future. It's likely that the export of health certificates for our products that we are exporting to the EU are costing around £300 per consignment, and that will be required for all trade in the EU in meat, fish and dairy products. The UK government must commit to upholding the standards set by the EU with regards to animal health and welfare to allow us to continue to trade. Finding ways of mitigating these costs for Scotland must be a priority for Westminster. And I'm going to expand a little bit on what Richard Lockhead said with his comments about our protected food status. Having spoken to many in the sector since the referendum, including the Galloway Cattle Society, another issue that has been raised consistently is that of products with protected food name status. Scotland has several geographical indication or GI products which are absolutely vital to the success of our food and drink sector, including Scottish farm salmon, beef, and Scotch lamb, and of course Scotch whisky. It's been mentioned already. They've been registered as GI in many countries across the world, including the EU. Recently, I met with the board of Quality Meat Scotland, and the importance of maintaining origin of food labelling was stressed to me. The provenance of Scottish produce lends itself to further economic development opportunities, which we cannot be allowed to have diluted. The recent trend towards attempting to market uniquely Scottish products as originating from the UK rather than Scotland is actually quite puzzling and even alarming. Recently, we've seen rebranding of Scottish strawberries, and Uair Haggis, the great chieftain of the pudding race, rebranded as British haggis, and Scotch whisky rebranded as UK whisky. Let us be clear, the strength and success of our food and drink industry nationally, right, £14 billion makes for a potential target for Theresa May's government. Presiding officer, it seems not only the job of the Tories to talk down Scotland, but also to drive down the economy of Scotland. Since 2014, no, I'm in my last couple of minutes. Since 2014, we have seen a sustained attack on Scotland's renewable energy, another sector which holds the potential for future economic benefit for the whole of Scotland. I strongly suspect that this has been done, at least in part, on the basis that were Scotland to fully utilise our natural resources, it would boost our economy beyond the reach of Westminster and in turn place the future of the Union at risk. The same cannot be allowed to happen to our food and drink sector, which is on track to hit a turnover of £16.5 billion by 2017. It is essential that products with protected food name status, such as Scottish beef, lamb and whisky, continue to be recognised at home and abroad. Unfortunately, the future of geographical indications relies on a UK scheme being put in place and a negotiation agreement with the EU for these to be recognised. I do not want to see our agricultural sectors left at the mercy of the Tories at Westminster. The livelihoods of real people, my constituents, depend on it. It is patently ridiculous for those in the Tory seats, even by their standards, to demand that the SNP clean up the Tory Brexit mess. It was created by them and their Westminster colleagues. However, I know that the Scottish Government will do its utmost to mitigate the damaging effects of this muckle-sized midden that is the Tory Brexit. I say to the Tories quite emphatically, in stark contrast to the shambolic state of affairs at Westminster, this Scottish Government has a plan. What we need from the Tories is urgent clarification on how the Prime Minister will deliver on her commitment to giving Scotland a full and equal say in the forthcoming negotiations and not just treat Scotland as window dressing. Thank you.
Lewis MacDonald, followed by Bruce Crawford.
Thank you very much. We agree with the government's motion today when it contends that rural interests are best served by protecting Scotland's place in Europe, maintaining membership of the single market and access to the free movement of labour. These are important objectives, but the difference between membership of the EU and membership of the single market is greater for the rural economy than it is for Scotland as a whole, and it is on that difference I want to focus today. Membership of the single market out with the European Union does not involve being part of the common agricultural policy. It does not involve being part of the common fisheries policy, and nor indeed does it guarantee tariff-free trade in the produce of those sectors with EU member states. This debate, therefore, goes to the heart of some of the choices that we face in a way which poses real challenges to both our governments. Theresa May will not say whether she will seek to negotiate continued membership of the single market, no doubt because there are some in her party in favour and some against. Nicola Sturgeon's response has been to insist that membership of the single market is essential to protecting Scotland's interests and is therefore a red line issue in discussions with the UK government. Now, membership of the single market means membership of the European Economic Area, which in turn requires the state to belong either to the EU or to EFTA, the European Free Trade Association. The EEA includes all the members of the EU and three of the four members of EFTA, Norway, Iceland and Liechtenstein. If membership of the single market after Brexit is the objective, we need to be clear about how that works for those members of the European Economic Area which do not belong to the European Union. That's why members of the European Committee visited Brussels in July to find out that difference for ourselves at first hand. We met the ambassadors to the European Union of two of those countries, Norway and Iceland, as well as the ambassador of Ireland, whose view of how it all works from a Northwest European perspective was also valuable. The European Economic Area requires its members to follow a raft of policies decided by the European Union. It is not just a common market for trade. Some 10,000 pieces of EU legislation apply across the EEA. These workers' rights, consumer rights, environmental protections all have the same legal force in Norway and Iceland as they do in Britain and Ireland. EEA member countries make contributions to EU cohesion funds in line with those they would make if they were in the European Union itself. They pay for their membership of the single market. Yet those countries are not subject to CAP or the CFP. They are not parties to Economic and Monetary Union or indeed to the European Customs Union. They do not benefit directly from European structural funds and they are not represented in the European Parliament or in the European Commission or the Council. Those exclusions are not incidental results of staying out with the European Union. Concerns about farming and fishing are precisely why Norway and Iceland did not choose to join the European Union as Britain, Ireland and Denmark had done, but chose to join and to form a single market with the European Union instead. For those countries, paying into the European Union while getting no payments back, being subject to EU law with no say in EU decision-making, facing tariff barriers to their exports of farm produce and fish are all a price worth paying in exchange for membership of the single market in goods and services, freedom of movement for labour and for capital, and the right to decide their own policies on agriculture and fisheries. Now, the bodies representing farming and fishing in Scotland have demanded that their sectoral interests should not be traded away as part of any future deal, and they are right to raise their concerns. The Scottish Government has made clear over recent weeks that their key priority is for Scotland to enjoy the benefits of membership of the single market. Those benefits do not extend to all of the rural economy because the European Union does not demand free trade in agricultural produce or in fish as a price of membership of the single market. Nor does membership provide access to Europe, of the single market provide access to European structural funds, Funds which are worth, for example, £11 million to Aberdeenshire alone in the current funding period, which have delivered £25 million of funding for environment and energy projects in the city of Aberdeen over the last 5 years. So there are a number of questions which I hope Scottish Government ministers will address at the end of this afternoon. I suspect Mr. Russell will be closing the debate. First of all, how European markets for food exports can be secured, given that the single market does not encompass farming and fishing. And if membership of the single market is indeed Nicola Sturgeon's one red line in discussions with UK ministers, what guarantees are there for Scottish farmers and fishermen that their interests will not be traded away in pursuit of that objective? If the answer to that question is that protecting farming and fishing is indeed a high priority, do Scottish Government ministers believe, like the governments of Norway and Iceland, that those sectors are best protected out with the single market as not being covered by any single market deal? And finally, what access can there be in future to European structural funds, since access to those funds is not part of the deal which members of the single market out with the European Union currently enjoy? Those questions, I believe, need to be addressed, indeed, by ministers in both governments, and I hope Mr. Russell will make a start on answering those questions at the close of this debate today.
Bruce Crawford, followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Since the announcement of the result of the referendum on the UK's EU membership on the 24th of June, one thing remains absolutely clear. Scotland wants to maintain her place within the European community. And that should be no surprise to anyone in this chamber, as Scotland reaps significant financial benefits from the EU, as well as numerous important rights and liberties, which now stand potentially to be lost. However, I'm pleased that at least the Scottish Government has committed itself to ensuring that our rural communities have their economic needs addressed and are empowered to generate their own economic growth and sustainability. The sustainability of Scotland's rural economy is not only vital for rural areas of Scotland, but for Scotland's economy as a whole. In supporting our rural communities, successive Scottish governments have benefited from much needed EU funding. As we know, the Common Agricultural Policy is the largest item of the EU budget, and Scottish farmers, including those in my own constituency, receive around €480 million a year in direct subsidies. And Scotland was set to receive around €500 million by 2020 in rural development funds. In future, any cuts to farm subsidies and rural areas from the UK government will have a knock-on effect, not just on farmers, but on ancillary rural economic activities dependent on farming. Now, my constituency has a big rural population who've in the past secured significant advantage from the various EU funding streams. Thousands of my constituents have benefited from countless projects thanks to these contributions from the EU. The EU-funded SRDP, for instance, has played a key role in my constituents by enhancing the rural economy, supporting agriculture and forestry businesses, and protecting the fantastic natural environment we have to offer. Take, for example, the LEADER programme, which I think Rhoda Grant quite rightly raised earlier, within the Forth Valley and Lomond area, encompassing my constituency. Stirling constituency was allocated £2.7 million by the Scottish Government using CAP Pillar 2 funding, which levered in an additional £3.6 million. But the Treasury has only been able to guarantee Pillar 1 funding until 2020 for farmers and crofters alike. But where does that leave us with the funding for rural development under Pillar 2? Just as the Tories are leaving EU citizens who've made Scotland their home in limbo, so too are our rural communities across Scotland who look likely to lose access to these vital schemes that they've enjoyed for many years. It concerns me, and it should concern everyone in this chamber, what the negative effect will be from the loss of such funding to the agricultural industry and the many community projects which are supported from these EU funds. Now, Rhoda mentioned LEADER earlier. LEADER's not only generated jobs and economic activity in my constituency, but it's played an important role in providing local groups on the ground with real practical help with the funding of projects to help local communities. The Balmaha Pontoon project, the refurbishment of Gurgunnock Community Hall, or the funding of the Jazz on the Lochs Festival in Callander are all some examples. with fabulous landscapes from forests and woods in my constituency through the SRDB forestry funding, Stirling Council has been awarded over £340,000 during the last EU session for the Woods in and Around Towns Fund. The demise of LEADER would deprive local businesses and communities across Scotland of tools to play an active role in shaping their own future. LEADER encourages innovation and responses to old and new problems and becomes a sort of laboratory for building local capabilities and capacities. Now, I'm also privileged to represent a large part of Loch Lomond and Trossachs National Park, as well as a number of other strategic landscape assets. Tourism and micro-businesses are the main economic drivers across the whole area, attracting large numbers of visitors from across the world, particularly during the peak tourism season. A large part of my constituency's revenue is based on the thousands of tourists who visit each month and spend their money in the welcoming and picturesque rural villages. Funding from the EU has helped ensure that these local villages receive financial support to enhance their offering to both tourists and locals alike. It's therefore with deep regret that I consider the effects of the UK's exit from the EU could have on these types of projects in Scotland. We need the UK government, frankly, we need the EU government to commit to supporting Pillar 2 funding in full now, before any further damage is done to the rural economy. Projects are already beginning to run into the sand, and people are no longer committing themselves to the future. That's the effect it's already having. That's not doom-mongering, as some of the Tories would. That's realistic on the ground. If you go and speak to people, you'll find out that's exactly what's happened. But I've got every confidence that my colleagues, Fergus Ewing and Mike Russell, will fully represent Scotland's interests in the upcoming discussions. It is vital that we demonstrate to Westminster and to our European colleagues how much we value the support we gain from our EU membership. Scotland's farmers and rural communities cannot be let down by the UK government. We must do all we can in Scotland to ensure the interests of all of our rural communities are fought for and fully represented in future Brexit negotiations. And I'll just leave with one thought, Presiding Officer, because we've heard a lot from the Tories about the SNP talking down Scotland this afternoon. That's effectively what you're being saying. But of course, it was David Mundell who said on the 23rd of June in the Daily Mail that all the economic experts predict the potential damage a Brexit would do to jobs, mortgages and the economy, and as across the whole of Scotland, is just too severe. That's coming from the Secretary of State himself. There are a number of quotes, loads and loads of quotes from Tories, including your own leader here in Scotland, that have demonstrated that how damaging that Brexit could be. But now you're running away from the reality that you painted the picture earlier into some sort of fantasy land that you're now living in, as if all that didn't exist, these comments were never made. And the presiding officer's telling me I'm coming close to my time anyway. So I'll just leave it at that. It's time you all grew up and played the real game.
Liam Kerr, to be followed by John Finney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There is something very special about our Scottish countryside, not only in itself, but also because it forms the basis for a rural economy, which generates billions of pounds every year. Our food and drink, whether whisky or salmon, Aberdeen Angus beef, Stornoway black pudding to haddock and chips, are celebrated and enjoyed the world over. Our sporting estates draw in millions of tourists a year, with tourism expenditure of billions of pounds, and they support vibrant and sustainable local economies. But despite this bright picture, the agricultural, fisheries and sporting sectors are facing crises, which have absolutely nothing to do with the UK's democratic decision to leave the European Union, or indeed, as Emma Harper suggests, the Tories. The farming industry, failed by a Scottish government which has botched the delivery of cap payments so badly that the value of outstanding bank loans to Scottish agriculture has risen to £2.2 billion. A fishing industry already facing further regulation from Brussels on how they are allowed to fish, left in limbo by a Scottish government that refuses to spend money on supporting an industry forced to pay for its own policing. Is it really a surprise that perhaps 95% of fishermen voted to leave the European Union? Both groups are fed up with the empty promises and posturing of the SNP, and both staged unprecedented protests outside the Scottish Parliament, demanding to be heard, demanding help. And our rural economy is so much more. Our sporting estates bring over £470 million to the economy and employ more than 8,000 people. Following the EU referendum, Scottish Lands and Estates, published a paper, the first paragraph of which states, "Exiting the EU potentially presents a unique opportunity to bring a new way of thinking about how to deliver safety, standards, and environmental outcomes, while removing unnecessary and costly burdens on businesses and lead the world." They go on to say the recent vote presents an opportunity to change specific EU regulations that work poorly for rural businesses, consumers and the countryside, and which are holding back growth in the rural economy and environmental improvements. Of course.
Stuart Stevenson.
Could he name three specific regulations he would revoke?
Liam Kerr.
I'm actually surprised, stunned in fact, that Stuart Stevenson dares to intervene on the rural economy. We had a debate last week about the increase in council tax. It is an increase that will hit Aberdeenshire homes and families disproportionately. 41% of families face an increase. No voice from the SNP was raised in protest, and certainly not elected MSPs from the northeast of Scotland. And that is a disgrace, Stuart Stevenson. Even if we leave out the considerable economic arguments on purely conservation and land management grounds, the estates of Scotland should be backed to the hilt and supported. But this government doesn't want to do that. Instead of providing assurance and positivity, we have land reform legislation that underlines the obsession with who owns what, rather than how the land can be best managed, using ambiguous terms which remain ill-defined and open to misinterpretation. Of course, something we've heard before about SNP legislation. The scrapping of rates relief on our sporting estates could have a devastating impact on these businesses, making many unprofitable and forcing gamekeepers, their families, and many other local trades out of work. These are businesses that make a key contribution to rural tourism, local employment, and the environment, attacked by reason of ideological prejudice. But that debate is for another day. No, I won't, thank you. Okay, go ahead.
Bruce Crawford.
I wonder whether the member really realises that by shooting the states not paying rates, what they're effectively doing is making sure that local shopkeepers are subsidising their activity. Is that not bad for this? Would that not be good for the Scottish economy in the whole term? That's a bit.
Liam Kerr.
If Mr. Crawford had been listening, he would have heard me say just at that point, that debate is for another day, and I will happily have it with him. But we are talking about the EU and coming out of the EU. My point, presiding officer, is that this government yet again is refusing to look at the positives, the opportunities to be taken from the UK's vote, as our rural sectors, and indeed Alex Neil, would like them to do. The Scottish Fishermen's Federation and Scottish Association of Fish Producers Organisations told us only yesterday this is an unexpected but welcome opportunity to deliver a significant boost to investment and employment in our rural economy. It is quite clear the biggest impediment to securing the interests of Scotland's rural economy is not the UK's democratic decision to withdraw from the EU, but is in fact this government, obsessed with land ownership and independence. It delivers merely incompetence. Why not put all of that aside and get back to the day job that they were elected to do? Sort the cap crisis, support our fishing industry, and once and for all end this petty obsession with punishing our sporting estates. Accordingly, I commend the amendment to the Chamber. Thank you.
One of the great mysteries of this Chamber is when I'm running out of time, everyone talks over. And when I have some time in hand, everyone comes in, even with interventions, under the allotted request time. So it's just to let remaining speakers know that there is a little bit of leeway available. So John Finney, followed by, and maybe I shouldn't have said this until after this speaker, Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Green Party will be supporting the Scottish Government's motion tonight, and never thought I would commence a speech by agreeing with Mr Mundell when the Cabinet Secretary quotes him saying the risks are too great, and Mr Crawford there outlines the remark that Mr Mundell said about the severity of the implications. And these implications aren't simply economic, they're also social benefits. My Highlands and Islands colleague Rhoda Grant talked about the infrastructure benefits that have come to the Highlands as a result of membership of the EU, and they're very apparent for everyone to see. I think the real question is, the big question is, what our countryside should look like. Now, certainly the view of the Scottish Green Party that our rural and coastal communities should be vibrant places. Lots of small communities owning, respecting and benefiting from natural resources, adequate housing, local schooling with a range of access to public services. And for that reason, we will also be supporting the Labour amendment as a reminder of the importance of broadband. And our rural economy, well, 98% of Scotland's landmass is rural, 18% of its population, 16% of its employment, 30% of its enterprises, and 40% of small and medium enterprises. They are vibrant but fragile places, and they are hallmarked to rural communities, multiple job holding, underemployment, seasonal employment, often linked to housing availability, and as has been outlined by more than one speaker, sectors dependent on migrant labour. So we cannot deal with the uncertainty that Brexit has visited upon us. Membership of the single market is mentioned in the motion. It's not about access, it is about membership that's important. And likewise, the motion mentions freedom of movement. And it's certainly the view of the Scottish Green Party that the Prime Minister should be spelling out her intentions to safeguard free movement of people, however likely that is. Allow for a separate membership deal for Scotland if necessary, and one that better reflects how we actually voted. The economic benefit to the UK of EU migrants is well documented. A few figures here from research from 2014 that during the period 2001 to 2011, £22 billion. More recently, an HMRC report, EU migrants made a positive contribution to the UK public finances of over £2.5 billion. In 2013-14. That's a significant figure. And it's a contribution, a positive contribution, that's particularly and keenly felt in rural areas with agriculture, hospitality, social care, which is very, very important for a growing and ageing population. But there is an opportunity to review, and we would say that we should be reviewing our policies regardless of what happens with the EU. We keenly want to stay in the EU. It's not without its flaws. People have acknowledged that. I would give one other example. The very virulent anti-EU newspaper owner, Mr Paul Dyker, resident of the Highlands Islands, he landed more than £250,000 in EU subsidies for his sporting estate in Wester Ross, and indeed another €13,000 in direct farm payments. Now, the previous Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs opposed payments in sporting estates, and I understand made representations to the EU, but it was said to be too loosely defined, and I hope that that's a position that continues, that the Scottish Government will pursue that. Grateful to the various organisations who have provided briefings, the Scottish Wildlife Trust, for instance, talk about four significant issues which will need to be addressed to achieve the best possible outcome for Scotland's natural environment. They talk about the future of environmental legislation, and we know that the EU has been responsible for a considerable volume of quality legislation that's made the world a better place. Funding to support sustainable land management. And it is an important issue, and welcome the Land Fund, obviously. And how Scotland achieves healthy seas. And that is about sustainable fisheries management. It's about local fisheries management. It's also recognising that fish don't recognise international boundaries and that will require international cooperation. And they also say, the final of their 4 points, ensuring Scotland remains at the centre of excellence for science and knowledge exchange. Now, perhaps rarely there was cross-party consensus on an issue that this impacts, and that was the agreement with post-study visas. And it's very unfortunate the UK government didn't pick up on that, for Scotland at least. Now, the Scottish Government recognises the importance of our rural communities, and natural capital is a key priority of the Scottish Government's economic strategy. And the Cabinet Secretary talked about the potential loss of 40 million trees, this with a well-known dip coming in our timber production. So Greens would see a different emphasis. We like smaller units of agriculture rather than the large agricultural businesses. It's only £350 million that supports the agri-environment schemes that's paid through the SRDP Pillar 2. It's not just us that think there's flaws. The recent Audit Scotland report on current CAP programme confirms this view. Failures with the present scheme. Of course, it's understandable there'd be direct payments to support food production. There's obvious benefits associated itself with that. But then Scots throw away 600,000 tonnes of food and drink every year, costing £1 billion. Agriculture and related land use contributes to 20% of total greenhouse gas emissions in Scotland, but on the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, we heard last week that there are steps being taken in respect of that. Intensive farming has a significant contribution to pollution too. We want to contrast the relatively small amount of money spent in agri-environment schemes through Pillar 2, which incentivises land managers to deliver public benefits. That's improving, promoting and providing public access, creating new habitats, removing non-native species, expanding native species, planting native woodland, supporting conservation grazing and restoring peatlands. One of the briefings that I read was from the Royal Society of Edinburgh that talked about establishing a new framework for all the areas covered, currently covered by the EU legislation, and they said it's a major task, and they questioned the staff resilience that would go with that. We rely very much on our staff and the various directorates, and this is a huge challenge if indeed we have to leave the EU. It's vitally important the Scottish Government's fully involved in negotiations, fully involved. As I understood it, unless other parties wish to say otherwise, they were charged with representing and protecting Scotland's interests in these negotiations, and certainly the Scottish Green Party wish to see that continuing and are appreciative of efforts thus far. It's very clear that the impacts of Brexit are far-reaching and that there will be challenges for Scotland's natural capital. It's vital that we have a vibrant and viable coastal and rural communities. It's very important we determine how best taxpayers' money is spent to maximise the benefits and achieve sustainable land management. We want that to take place within the EU. We want that within the single market. We want freedom of movement. That's a red line issue for us, failing which we'll chart our own destiny. Thank you very much indeed.
Stuart Stevenson, followed by Mike Rumbles. Within reason, please, Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, for your confidence in my the value of my contribution. Let me just start by saying the Tories might be well advised not to try and fight previous battles. Mr. Chapman referred to independence 4 times in the first 2 minutes of his speech, 7 times in all. We've had one additional reference from Dean Lockhart. In last week's debate, he made 15 references to independence. I'm going to focus on the subject of today's debate because that's what matters to rural people in Scotland. And let me start, Presiding Officer, by saying the Scottish Fishermen's Federation is absolutely correct when they talk about the opportunities that derive from Brexit. I have, throughout my entire political life, campaigned against the common fisheries policy. There's no change from this member of the parliament. But what we have to be absolutely careful about is that Westminster is not allowed to sell out interests of our fish catching sector once again, as they did when they took us into the common fisheries policy. Tory government did that. We can't allow Tory government to do that again. The National Farmers Union, too, I want to agree with. The National Farmers Union seeks common ground on major red lines, future trade agreements, agricultural support, and labour in their industry. So I hope that we can make progress in this debate and agree that it's important that our agricultural industries continue to have access to labour. It's fishing, it's agriculture. Scottish strawberries might be under threat if we can't get people to come and pick them. But on fishing, the issue of most concern to my constituents, it's control over our fishing grounds that is a must-win issue for fishing communities in Scotland and beyond. The chief executive of the National Federation of Fishermen's Organisations, which is roughly the English equivalent of RSFF, said in Fishing News last week, the issues will be access, our boats in other nations' waters, foreign boats in ours. And he's correct. In the murky waters of international negotiations, it seems anything goes. Internal negotiations within the UK illustrate this. Generally, decisions simply handed down from UK ministers. We've seen in the last year a delay over summer monkfish swap that the Cabinet Secretary referred to, preference given to English whitefish trawlers rewhiting an Arctic cod, top slicing of North Sea whiting from Scotland handed to English inshore fleet, and an allocation of an excessive amount of mackerel again to the English inshore fleet. So in determining a UK position, there must be agreement from all the jurisdictions that are affected by this issue, not simply a position that reflects the needs of one. Now, Scottish ministers are well used to representing the UK and agreed UK positions on the international stage. A quick look at my ministerial diaries identified at least five such occasions where I represented the UK, representing a UK position. But negotiations, of course, proceed in part along paths determined by the party on the opposite side of the table. And that means one has to have a minister at the top of his or her game to lead on negotiations. Now, as it happens in Scotland, we have some of the best negotiation trainers in the world. And I write in today's Banffshire Journal about their methods. And if you want to read my comments, they can be read at negotiate.stuartstevenson.scot. So they'll be excellent, Mr. Rumbles, well worth the read. So to give our industry confidence, we need a minister leading fisheries negotiations for the UK who has a bigger stake in the outcome than any UK minister is likely to have. It needs to be a Scottish minister. And it's also likely to be good for UK fishermen out with Scotland, as such a minister is much less likely to sell out fishing industries for some undisclosed trade-off, as happened 40 years ago. Let's look at the position of Tory UK Scottish Secretary David Mundell, a rich source of quotes. In the Press and Journal, he said, "The idea we would go back to a position where we were entirely in control of our own fishing is not one that is realistic. Sold out again by the Tories before the talks have even started, just like the CFP and the Tories." But equally, we must consider the position of communities dependent on processing the bounty of our seas, from the artisanal smokehouses and processors in small west coast and island communities to the large industrial processors in my constituency and elsewhere. For them, access to labour and access to market are vital. The EU is the largest fish market in the world, and it takes in particular premium products which have the highest margins and therefore contribute differentially to higher profits than other markets. Outside the single market, even when there is access to it, countries find it particularly difficult to export to the EU without cost and time penalties and without discrimination against particular fish species and particular food products. And without the many foreign nationals who work in fish processing, production must inevitably drop. We simply can't staff the factories in Banffshire and Buchan Coast, in Fraserburn, in Peterhead in particular, without nationals coming from elsewhere. Now, the government in the UK is as opaque as ever in its plans. There is an emerging indication of what is called the hard Brexit, and others have made reference to that, but that would hit fishing communities particularly hard and undermine the advantages derived from leaving the common fisheries policy. Presiding officer, we've seen that the Tories are trying to cover this debate, cover their failures by referring to other matters. I think the issue that has really got us to the point that we're in the blank sheet of paper that is the plan for Brexit, still a blank sheet of paper. Contrast with what happened in 2014, when there was a 650-page document able to be analysed and attacked, dissected, of the plans that there were. Let me close, Presiding Officer, by simply quoting the Austrian Empire's foreign minister in the 1800s, Count Metternich. Events which cannot be prevented must be directed. The Brexit cannot now be prevented. It's time for a wee bit of direction from the UK government, and if they won't do it, we'll tell them what to do.
Mike Rumbles, followed by Joan McAlpine.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I very much welcome the opportunity this debate gives to highlight the challenges which our rural economy faces in the post-EU world. Now, each time Fergus Ewing has attended the Rural Economy Committee, I've tried to raise the long-term interests of the Scottish rural economy with him. But each time, he's either veered off, blaming the UK government for its lack of planning on this, or tried to avoid my questions at all. Indeed, at his last appearance at the committee, when I asked him if he'd set up a team of civil servants to look at future funding for the rural economy post-2020, he seemed outraged that I had even the temerity to ask him such a question, and he couldn't get out of the committee room door fast enough. Unfortunately, the minister, and we've heard it again today at his opening remarks, is obviously more interested in criticising the UK government for its lack of openness and forward planning than getting to grips with the forward planning he needs to be doing for the future of Scotland's rural economy post-2020. Deputy Presiding Officer, if I can outline why I strongly believe that the Scottish Government is failing in its duty here. When the UK joined the common market, we inherited a common agricultural policy designed to fit German, French and Italian farmers. We did not join a system designed for British, let alone Scottish agriculture. We joined a very unsatisfactory system whereby whole sectors of our industry were left without farm support. And those with it were mired in bureaucracy. We all know about the bureaucracy in this field. Members may not be aware, however, that farm subsidies are allocated in a very strange way. But let me outline what I believe many people find strange about the current distribution of farm subsidies in Scotland. In 2015, while the average farm subsidy was £31,000, the average farm income was £23,000. That is an average loss before the subsidy of £8,000 a farm. The average farm is losing £8,000 a year. Over 38% of our farms either made a loss or had incomes of less than £10,000, even with the subsidy. We can see how reliant some of our farms are on the EU subsidies and how many of our farms are at risk without them. However, these dreadful figures mask other figures which show that 5% of our farms, that's 1 in 20, receiving the average of £31,000 in subsidies, have farm incomes in excess of £100,000. Now, there's huge variation here, and we are subsidising everybody in these sectors, in the sectors that receive it. Once we leave the EU, when we leave, we are leaving, these farm subsidies become entirely the responsibility of Scottish ministers. Agriculture is entirely devolved. I find it astonishing, that Fergus Ewing, the responsible Scottish minister, has not already sparked on this. Please, I'd love to give way.
Fergus Ewing.
What Mr. Rumbles has completely failed to mention, Presiding Officer, is that whilst agriculture is devolved, the subsidy and payment mechanism for agriculture is reserved because it comes from the CAP. And therefore, can he answer me this question? I've pointed out in this debate that Pillar 2 funding has not been guaranteed by the UK government, and it has been mentioned by many members, although not by the Conservatives. Do the Liberals agree that the Pillar 2 payments should and must be guaranteed by the UK government before anybody can engage in proper budget former planning, because we do not know what our budget will be?
Right, if
Mr.
I can
Rumbles,
respond,
Mr.
This
Rumbles,
is
Mr. Rumbles, Mr. Rumbles, you allowed the intervention, and I allowed it to happen. When somebody's intervening, you should sit in your seat and not stand up till you respond. Thank you.
Deputy Presiding Officer. That sort of intervention from the Minister is typical of his behaviour throughout the whole of this process. He knows, as well as everybody else that should know, that while at the moment we are in the EU, these are reserved, but they are not reserved because the EU will disappear. And agriculture is entirely resolved, and you are fit. The presiding officer, the minister in charge of Scottish agriculture is failing in his duty not to forward plan, even to come up with the options for what it might look like in the future. So just be quiet, just be quiet. Not to do so, to me, not to do so looks to me like the height of irresponsibility. We have the chance, with an almost blank piece of paper, to reform the system of farm support in Scotland. It is the Minister's chance to design a new system suited to Scotland's needs post-2020, not to simply go on as before. We've become used to a lack of forward planning by Scottish ministers here. The shambles of farm payments, money which should have been paid out to farm businesses some 9 months ago, still remain unpaid. Fergus Ewing is actually so lacking in confidence about this year's farm payments that he's boasting about giving 80% of what farmers are due to them in December, 1 month early. This will still leave the average farm business some £6,000 out of pocket. And this is something to boast about out of an average income of 23. I see the minister shaking his head, but he needs to face the facts. It seems to me that we've had an unprecedented shambles of farm payments systems from last year. We're continuing with that shambles this coming year, and that unless Fergus Ewing starts to put his thinking cap on and continue to have, we'll have one shambles after another. It is particularly galling to think that while he continues to criticise others, and we've heard all of that, there are many things they do need to be criticised, but not constantly. I think it's important that the Scottish Government takes its own responsibilities before casting aspersions on others. It's anybody's fault but his own. He fails to do the simplest of forward planning exercises about how he wants to see the future of farm support subsidies post-2020. We've heard absolutely nothing about what the future he wants to see for Scottish agriculture. Absolutely nothing in this debate. We're only 4 years away. Is he seriously saying that he will simply carry on with a totally unsuitable system, or will he even at this late stage actually do some forward planning? For goodness sake, Minister, get a grip.
Joan McAlpin to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Rhoda Grant talked about broadband and the support offered to that infrastructure by Brussels, and she also rightly pointed out that social justice aspects are absolutely key in providing better broadband and the access to roaming charges reductions that we've seen as a result of EU policy has been very welcome in that regard too. Mobile connectivity is absolutely essential to the economic prosperity of rural Scotland, and I'm pleased that the Labour amendment highlights connectivity, and I look forward to supporting it. Now, on that subject, the Cabinet Secretary mentioned that he was still waiting for answers from a number of UK government ministers, and I'm waiting for a specific answer on connectivity. Earlier this month, I wrote to Matt Hancock, the Minister of State for Digital and Culture, and asked whether the UK government will be able to match the commitment of the EU to the rollout of the next generation of mobile connectivity across Europe. In a State of the Union address recently, Jean-Claude Juncker, the President of the European Commission, committed the EU to fully deploy the next generation of mobile technology, 5G, across the EU by 2025. And by 2020, he said, the EU will equip every village and city with free wireless internet around the main centres of public life. It's a hugely ambitious promise and an excellent example of the EU stepping in, where in the past the UK government has singularly failed rural Scotland and indeed other rural parts of the UK. Telecommunications is an issue entirely reserved to Westminster, and earlier auctions of 3G and 4G licences by the UK government may have raised billions for the Treasury in awarding those licences, but the operators were only asked to meet a certain level of per-head coverage. In the case of Scotland, that was set at 95% for 4G, although when 3G was awarded to Scotland, there was no guarantee at all. In both cases, it was per-head coverage, which is not an effective marker for a rural area. We need geographical guarantees to ensure coverage out with urban areas, and it's the lack of those geographical guarantees set by the UK government which means that rural Scotland is the worst served area when it comes to mobile connectivity of any part of the UK. Now, Mr Juncker's guarantee would have stepped into this giant knot spot created by successive Westminster governments, and that's why I've asked Matt Hancock to fund the 5G that we'll now not get from the EU if Brexit goes ahead, and I still don't take that as a fait accompli. If the Scottish Tories really cared about rural Scotland, they would demand answers from Mr Hancock as well.
Jamie Green.
I will take him.
I thank John McAlpine for giving way. You should be pleased to learn that I'm meeting Mr Hancock next Sunday, and be pleased to pass on any questions you have for the Minister.
John McAlpine.
Yeah, I welcome that, and I'll send you the letter that I'm still awaiting a reply to. I also like to go on to talk about farming, since Peter Chapman had focused on it at the beginning of the debate. I'd just like to quote something about my own south of Scotland region. For many of my constituents in the Borders with farm businesses, the EU offers a critical level of support through the Common Agricultural Policy. In fact, nearly 40% of the European budget is dedicated to the agricultural sector, and EU membership offers tariff-free market access for Scottish produce with an export value of £5.1 billion in 2014, a fact that every business across the country should be aware of. That was John Lamont, the MSP for Ettrick, Roxburgh, Berwickshire, a Conservative in this Parliament. And it's another example of what the Tories said before the referendum and how they now changed their tune after the referendum. Specifically on farming, I would like assurances as to how the Common Agricultural Payment replacement is going to be distributed across the UK if Brexit goes ahead. We've been told that funding payments for farming will continue, but we don't know how that is actually going to make its way to Scotland. Now, evidence that the European Committee received from the Fraser of Allender Institute pointed out that Scotland's share of CAP payment is at 18% of the UK population, which is obviously well above Scotland's share of the UK population. So how will a Tory Treasury guarantee that funding? The Fraser of Allender kind of gave us a gentle warning that at the moment, the only way to transfer funds from the Treasury to Scotland is via the Barnett formula, which of course gives us just a little more than our 9% population share. It's certainly nowhere near the 18% that we get from CAP. So will the Tories today, in their summing up, guarantee that Scotland will get its current share of CAP after Brexit, that 18% of UK population? My concern is that the record isn't good when it comes to standing up for Scotland against the UK Treasury. We all know, observers of these matters know, that the Treasury has been trying to cut Scotland's funding by doing away with Barnett. It's wanted to do away with Barnett for years. And during the fiscal framework negotiations, the Treasury tried to put a £7 billion price tag on the new powers that this Parliament was promised. Now, I'm very pleased that the Labour Party eventually got behind the Scottish Government to stand firm in defence of Scotland's interests during that debate. And we held out, and it was the UK Government that blinked first, and we got a guarantee that we wouldn't lose that £7 billion. But the Scottish Tories were absolutely no help whatsoever. They refused to stick up for Scotland, and I think at one point David Mundell said that £7 billion was us making a mountain out of a molehill. So does anyone really believe that the Tories, the Scottish Tories, will stick up for us when it comes to making sure that we get a continuing share of those cap payments. I very much doubt that they will. In fact, one of the leaders of the Brexit campaign, I'm sad to say, a Scottish-born Tory himself, Michael Gove, actually hinted at this during the referendum campaign when he talked about a fair union funding settlement post-Brexit. We all know for many years that when Tories talk about fair funding for Scotland, they don't mean more money.
Finlay Carson, to be followed by James Kelly.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Britain's leaving the European Union is the result of the decision made on the 23rd of June. It was not the outcome I'd hoped for or voted for, but as a Democrat, unlike some of the members in the middle of this chamber, I respect the democratic will of the people. Since the referendum, much has been made of the fact that the majority in Scotland voted to remain, as they did in London and Northern Ireland. What seems to have been forgotten, though, is that over 1 million Scots voted to leave. And a large proportion of that vote came from the rural communities of Scotland, communities like my own in Dumfries, Galloway and West Dumfries, who feel that they're not being listened to in Edinburgh, never mind in Brussels. And that, Presiding Officer, is why the real threat to our rural economy at the moment is not Brexit, but rather this SNP government, who's... I'm still in my first opening minute, thank you. This SNP government who stifle any ambition to deliver real and meaningful action in our rural communities and seem hell-bent on pressing ahead with a centralising agenda that will decimate valued local services. Only 2 weeks ago, the Cabinet Secretary came into this chamber and tried to promote the cap payment crisis as a good news story. However, everyone knows that this cap fiasco is set to continue. Let's not forget that the consequences of this has resulted in cash flow problems for the whole of the rural economy. This when farmers are already suffering from low commodity prices, for example, receiving less money for their grain in 2015 than they did 30 years ago. This is additional uncertainty. It's a hammer blow for the vital Scottish industry, and the government have still not managed to get a grip on the situation. Even last week, a member of the Dumfries processing team told one of my staff members that a local farmer would receive payment by the end of the week, only to be contradicted by another senior officer in Edinburgh, who said that there was, and I quote, no chance of that happening, as things were in too big of a mess. You really couldn't make it up. And the repercussions, we know, go much wider than just farming, with local businesses being dependent on farms and our local tradesmen right through to our local grocery stores. The SNP can't run away from the fact that their mishandling starved our rural economy of £400 million worth of investment. The blame for this crisis lies squarely at the foot of the Scottish Government, and they will be held responsible for their incompetency. Over the last few months, I've met with some of Scotland's fishing representatives from Peterhead to Kakubri, and they can't be more optimistic and excited about the future. In the recent briefing paper entitled Scottish Fisheries Post-Brexit, A Sea of Opportunity, the Scottish Fishermen's Federation talks about the unique opportunity to establish a more effective and reactive fishery management system, creating a fairer and more appropriate share of catching opportunities for Scottish fishermen, to direct any grant funding in ways more suited to Scotland than the EU currently allows, and use Britain's new role in the world post-Brexit to explore new markets for seafood and rapidly expanding economies outside the EU. The opportunities are endless, Presiding Officers, but these ideas and opportunities will be wasted if this SNP government continues to maintain such an intransigent position towards Brexit. So far from Brexit being feared in our fishing sector, it is being welcomed and embraced. Sadly, that cannot be said about the actions and policies of the SNP government. In my own constituency, I've been contacted by a number of local fishermen and businesses affected by the government's ill-thought-out policies on restricted salmon fishing. As one gentleman put it, the restrictions signify a death knell for all West Coast rivers and have already had an adverse effect on our rural economy with angling clubs, tackle shops, hotels and holiday lets that cater specifically for fishermen all reporting a disastrous year. As with many other policies that directly affect rural Scotland, the government completely disregarded both the scientific research and the views of people working on the ground when it came to making up this legislation. As the Government prepares to bring forward a wild fisheries bill in this Parliament, I hope that the Cabinet Secretary will adopt a more reasoned and engaging approach to harnessing the knowledge of our local people to come up with a local river-based management structure and not the typical one-size-fits-all policy adopted far too often by this centralising government. One way of giving a much-needed boost to the royal economy would be the designation of new national parks, a claim supported in a report by the Scottish Campaign for National Parks, which argues that areas such as Dumfries and Galloway, the Borders and the Hebridean Islands, the far north and west of Scotland, could all benefit from the growth in their visitor numbers and larger tourism economy. Despite there being more than 3,500 national parks across the globe, Scotland only has two. It would cost an estimated £7 million to establish a national park, but the consequential economic benefits we've expected to significantly outweigh that. At the recent election, the Scottish Conservatives recognised the role and importance of the rural Scotland to the Scottish economy, and that is why at the election we committed to a South of Scotland enterprise that would have been a social as well as an economic enterprise, the key difference between Scottish enterprise and the Highlands and Islands today. Such a body would focus on delivering tangible outcomes for the communities in the south of Scotland. I would encourage the Scottish Government to look at this proposal seriously and demonstrate to the people of my constituency and across the south of Scotland that they realise that what is good practice in Govan isn't necessarily the best approach in Gatehouse of Fleet. Presiding Officer, Scotland's rural communities deserve better. Rather than coming to the Chamber today and disguising their failures through the prism of Brexit, the Government would have benefited from bringing forward real proposals on how they plan to deliver for rural Scotland. The reality is that Scotland's rural communities have suffered most under this SNP Government, who fails to realise that one-size-fits-all approach doesn't work. Only today I received correspondence from a new group set up to be a united voice for the riding of the marches, festivals and galas in Dumfries and Galloway. This has partly been brought about by unreasonable policing requirements being imposed on rural events, all based on Central Belt good practice. And one of our festivals didn't go ahead this year, the Wicker Man, due in no small part to new policing requirements, depriving our area of hundreds of thousands of pounds of income.
Can you wind up, please?
Why doesn't the Scottish Government listen to rural communities? We have huge potential in rural Scotland, Presiding Officer, and a great opportunity has arisen to re-energise our rural areas. This Government needs to, in the words of Mike Russell, grasp the thistle and deliver for my constituents and the rest of Scotland.
Thank you. I call James Kelly, followed by Gail Ross, and we are now getting close to not having any extra time. I might give you half a minute.
Not sure that I'll need it, Deputy Presiding Officer. Thank you very much, and I do welcome the opportunity to take part in this afternoon's debate. It's been very interesting for me as someone who doesn't represent a rural region or constituency, you know, to listen to the contributions from members across the chamber. And I think what it brings home is not only the contribution that rural Scotland makes to the economy and to the life of people in those rural communities, but also the disastrous impact of the Brexit vote in rural Scotland. And it does strike me, you know, when I listen to some of the contributions from the Tory benches, that you know, there's a bit of a lack of self-awareness. You know, looking at some of the weekend press coverage, you know, around the how the Brexit campaign was conducted within the Tory party, you get a real sense that people were more interested in manoeuvring for their own political positions than they were considering the impact of the Brexit vote. I mean, David, let's not get away from the fact that David Cameron brought forward the vote in order to try and quell internal critics from within his own ranks. And it's been an absolute disaster, just let me finish this point, an absolute disaster, not only for the country, but for David Cameron's political career.
Mr. Lockhart.
Just very briefly to remind the member that the Labour Party in Westminster supported holding the referendum.
Mr. Kelly.
Yeah, and we campaigned very strongly for a Remain vote. You know, I think if you look at even just a mere look at those weekend press coverings, all you can see is people briefing, manoeuvring against each other. It's quite clear that your party was split and they had taken their, their eye off the ball in terms of what was the impact. Because what has been clear listening to the contributions, it's the impact that this has on the rural economy, the wider Scottish economy, and on people's lives. You know, if you take the point in the Labour amendment about support for the digital economy and support for broadband, that's one of the things that's really changed in terms of people's lifestyle and, you know, business and industry in the last 10 years, is the real growth in access to broadband and super fast internet. But we know from the different contributions from Rhoda Grant and also from Joan McAlpine about the potential draining of EU funding to broadband access, and we know how important that is going to be in rural areas. I mean, only this week we saw the report from the Carnegie Trust on highlighting what a priority broadband access requires, and if it's not given that priority, it can result in social exclusion for some individuals and communities. Because bearing in mind the kind of layout of rural Scotland, there are a lot of isolated communities who have difficulty accessing this broadband and accessing the internet, and that not only limits those individuals in terms of their access to information and their enjoyment of lifestyle, but it also undermines the growth of businesses in those areas. So I think there's got to be a greater priority given to ensuring that funding is secured going forward. I mean, it's similar to the arguments that have been made in relation to agriculture. We heard Stuart Stevenson say, Bruce Crawford say that, you know, of the impact of £500 million of farm payments by 2020, if we start to lose money of that magnitude, then it will have an impact on the 66,500 people who work in the agriculture side of the economy. I think the other point from an EU perspective is the contribution the EU nationals make to the rural economy. It's reckoned that between 5 and 15,000 of them contribute to seasonal work, you know, many in fruit farms. And I think continued uncertainty about the future of EU nationals is not only no use for those individuals, but potentially undermines the overall economy. So I think in these, the three examples that I've highlighted, the digital economy, agriculture, and the importance of the role of EU nationals, it shows the potential for a real undermining of the rural economy, and that will affect on the overall economy, as some of the members have contributed, on areas like the food and drink certainty. I think what's needed in the debate going forward is we need some certainty, particularly from the UK government. We've had a summer of uncertainty, and people not only deserve answers, but they deserve a proper plan going forward. And I think it needs a good, proper debate. This debate has been that. I think the SNP government would be well advised to concentrate on the issues as opposed to pursuing the dream of some of their supporters for an independence referendum. It's been interesting in recent weeks to see the likes of Kenny McCaskill and Alec Neil concentrate more on the issues and caution against charging towards an independence referendum. And I think others on these benches would be well advised to do likewise. So summing up, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think this is a very important debate. It emphasises the importance of the rural economy and the contribution that the EU makes. And I think moving forward, we need greater clarity and a bigger priority to this debate.
Thank you, Mr Kelly. Gail Ross, we followed by Brian Whittle. Ms Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I begin, I would like to bring the Chamber's attention to my register of interest, in which I list being a board member of North Highland College. And I will go on to speak about that now. I've been a board member since 2014, and we've had many discussions regarding funding, where it comes from and how it's spent. The North Highland College is a partner in the University of the Highlands and Islands. What we do know is, and this is not scaremongering, this is research, Brexit will affect UHI more acutely than any other university in the Scottish sector. EU funding represents 35% of UHI's external income. Over £200 million in the last 20 years has been gained from EU funding. Therefore, Brexit will see a cut of 35% to UHI's external funding stream. Loss of European structural funds will mean a proposed £19 million cut of additional student places funding, student support, curriculum development to meet business and public sector skill requirements. Cross-border EU finance collaboration, such as the Horizon 2020, which UHI has been playing a leading role in, will no longer be open to UHI. That will impact not just on the ideas and cooperation, but it will wrench UHI from a key international body where it was playing a leading role. Horizon 2020 is developing ideas on offshore development and carbon reduction, which are crucial to the economy of the north of Scotland. EU engagement has been at the heart of development of the UHI for the last 20 years, and support from the EU has been fundamental in developing an integrated system. There has been significant investment in teaching and research facilities, the information and communications technology which underpins this, and course development and delivery. You could say that UHI would not be as strong or as diverse if it was not for the unstinting support that it has received from the EU over the years. The award-winning Environmental Research Institute at North Highland College have told me that they will lose two PhD studentships next year, which had already been allocated as part of a European funding package. At this point, some other EU organisations are wary of including them on any EU grant applications, as their status in the near future is unclear, to say the least. So at the moment, financial impact is not being felt. Ongoing projects are still being funded. But this, Presiding Officer, is very much the calm before the storm. It is the next round of funding, or lack of it, that could see massive implications for this academic institution. Potentially, this could lead to a significant shortfall in funding, and they would struggle to maintain their current staffing levels. But it's not only the UHI in the Highlands that relies on EU funding. Successive EU structural fund programmes have allowed for almost £1 billion of investment to the Highlands and Islands since 1990. The EU has been the principal driver in regional policy that has seen special attention paid to regions with lacking GDP compared with the EU average and or particular economic and social challenges. Inward migration from the EU has helped staff get many crucial jobs in the tourism and food and drink industries in the Highlands and Islands, as we have heard from colleagues in the Chamber. And as well as increasing population in the area, which is vital in the Highlands and Islands, there are estimated to be more than 10,000 EU nationals working and studying and contributing to the Highlands and Islands. This equates to around 2% of the population. What future for them post-Brexit? The UK government will not say, and shame that we are even considering using them as pawns in negotiations. The EU single market is worth £11 billion per annum to Scotland and is the main destination for Highlands and Islands exports. Retaining easy access to the single market is fundamental to the export competitiveness of businesses. Highlands and Islands Enterprise and regional partners are considering the future shape of regional policy. While the responsibility for regional policy will not become clear until post-referendum negotiations progress, a continued focus on the specific development challenges and opportunities of regions like the Highlands and Islands, backed up by appropriate resources, is necessary. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I find it unbelievable in these times of forced austerity that the answer from the UK government is to take even more away with a hard Brexit. This isn't the best of both worlds that we were promised in 2014. Actually, it's the worst of all worlds.
Thank you. Call Brian Whittle to be followed by Richard Lyle, and Mr. Lyle will be the last speaker in the open debate. Mr. Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. What we have here is an opportunity to scrutinise the health of our rural economy, and part of that scrutiny should focus within our own borders and to our own potential actions. Now, our farmers and fishermen are among the most stringently legislated food producers in the world. Our farmers are charged with the custodianship of the countryside, and our fishermen land world-class produce in the most testing of circumstances. However, they are not competing in a world where the playing field is even. For example, although we do not import meat from certain countries because of the way they develop their livestock, they still flood the global market with cheap produce, driving down the selling price. The government imposed a blanket ban on GM crops, slamming the door on research which could have benefited our farmers and farmers from around the world. We ensure that they pay a living wage far higher than many of their competitors. Our fishermen adhere to a very strict quota system, and the processing capabilities in Scotland have not been developed in line with production. Milk, for example, where we import dried milk from as far afield as New Zealand, and our farmers have to send their milk outside of our borders to get it processed. All of the above would be acceptable if we then recognise the increasing cost of food production that these rules incur and ensure that the playing field was levelled for our farmers and fishermen. It would be acceptable if the government who imposes these rules ensured the increased costs were mitigated against in the interest of fair competition. However, that is not the case here. Using freedom of information requests, a picture of where our government department's sources its food emerges, and the picture is one of inconsistency. There are great examples of best practice in regions where food is sourced locally and prepared on site. But there are also examples where food is purchased through third parties, where its source cannot be readily identified and is prepared in a way that can affect nutritional quality. Take our hospitals, for example, where you would expect nutritional quality of food to be the first and most important question in the procurement process. It speaks to the patient recuperation and rehabilitation, and therefore speaks to the time spent in a hospital bed. There are hospitals who source their local produce and prepare the food on site in their own kitchens. There are those who receive food that has been cooked off-site, sometimes a significant distance away, flash frozen, transported to the hospital, and then rehydrated and reheated prior to serving. Moreover, the source of this food is often unknown to the purchaser. The variance in daily cost per patient is a major concern for me, with some health boards quoting £7.50 a day per patient, while others quoting as little as £2.50 per day. There is no way that quality of produce can be universal with such a significant difference. There are reports of high levels of wastage, with patients pushing unpalatable food around their plates, leaving it uneven. Serving low-cost, low-quality food, of course, is a false economy. What patients need is a high-quality, nutritious food at a time when rehabilitation demands it, leading to reduced time spent in a hospital bed, exactly the kind of food that our rural economy consistently produces. Our schools are another example. East Ayrshire Council source all their produce locally and can even tell you which farm in the area they get their eggs from. They even told me yesterday they could name the hen that laid them, although I wasn't quite sure whether they were being serious. I am sure the Chamber would agree that this approach to feeding healthy local produce to our children should be applauded. I would have thought it would have been the norm. If East Ayrshire can do this effectively, why can't all other areas? And finally, for the Scottish Prison Service, only a third of their food suppliers are Scottish-based.
Can I say, I'm letting you continue along this line. It's sort of tenuous, tenuously connected to the amendment.
Stick with me, DPO.
Just.
I'll get there.
I'm waiting with bated breath, and that breath is running out.
What this highlights is a governmental department procurement process that is flawed and in need of a major overhaul. Squeezing budgets to a point where food quality is compromised in critical health areas is surely unacceptable. I will take
Cabinet Secretary.
I mean, I thank Mr. Whittle giving way, but I mean, has he heard of Excel? Is he aware of the work that they do? Does he appreciate that a great many businesses in farming, one of whom I met earlier today, actually recognise that Excel and its procurement policy, it ensures that to a great extent, food produce is bought in Scotland from Scottish producers and Scottish farmers. Is he aware of any of this?
Mr. Whittle.
As I said at the start of my speech, Minister, I used freedom of information across all of the health trusts to find out exactly where everybody sourced their food. So I'm only quoting from them. So I would ask you to do the very same as I did. It's an opportunity for government to support our rural economy, an opportunity to allow our rural economy to be a major solution in improving the health and well-being of our country. The answers lie in our hands. Join up the dots. Now, I've heard time and again from this government how their hands are tied by Westminster, how they're unable to act in the interest of Scotland because of Westminster. And if only they had more powers, they could sort all our ills and woes. Do you know what I hear every time they peddle that line? Ineffective government. Yes, a decade of an SNP government, ineffective in its policies and ideas, unable to break away from a narrow narrative that keeps their minds closed to possibilities and their minds closed to opportunities. Well, let me tell you, it's getting old and it's time to change the record. This government has it in its powers to be a much more solid supporter of the rural economy, the power to create a circular economy where the highest quality food produced by our farmers and fishermen makes it onto the Scottish dinner table, where the highest quality Scottish produce continues to be lauded across Europe and further afield. It's a big world out there. It's time to think big. Now, many of us didn't vote for Brexit, but that is the will of the British people, and this SNP government needs to stop its... I'm nearly finished, thank you. And this SNP government needs to stop its constant talk of doom and gloom, its constant pointing south with feigned indignation, and take its place at the negotiating table, accept its responsibility to the Scottish people, be a strong voice for Scotland, get the best deal for our rural economy, ensure that our farmers and fishermen can make the very best of the opportunities that now present themselves. My question to this SNP government is quite simple. Will you finally accept your responsibilities and get behind our rural economy?
Thank you. Thank you. Richard Lyle, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin my remarks this afternoon by sharing how much I've enjoyed listening to the various contributions by colleagues across the chamber in this debate? It's made me smile, some of the contributions. It's a pleasure contributing to this debate, particularly as a member of the Parliament's Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee. The result of the EU referendum on the 23rd of June made so many things uncertain. In fact, there are only a few things that I think are certain. One, that Brexit means Brexit. Brexit, but we don't quite know what Brexit means. Some on the Tory benches who voted Leave, and I'm trying to find out who it was, have put their country in a position that is total chaos, non-action by the UK government. And two, the people of Scotland unequivocally made clear their expressed desire to remain in the European Union. And I support my SNP government in exploring every avenue to keep Scotland in the EU. It is therefore incumbent upon us all across this chamber now to work to protect the economic future of Scotland, and in particular our rural economy and communities that are particularly vulnerable to the uncertainty caused by the EU referendum. I know that we in these benches, and I'm sure some others across the chamber, are equally determined to do what it takes to make sure this desire by the Scottish people to stay in the EU is recognised, respected and protected. Presiding Officer, our rural economy benefits from a share of some £4 billion received in EU funding and an estimate of £12 billion in food and drink exports over the period 2014-2020, as well as the value from the contribution made by the tens of thousands of EU nationals who choose to live and work in rural Scotland. Our membership of the EU cannot be understated nor undervalued. In fact, the EU is Scotland's biggest overseas food and drink export market. It is therefore essential that we continue to retain access to a single market of over 500 million people. Not to do so would be disastrous. From access to significant investment for Scotland, supporting thousands of jobs in rural economies, to the role of the EU structural funds in supporting important economic, employment and social priorities, helping to grow Scotland's economy. The EU has delivered for Scotland. And let's not forget that. And whilst the UK government and the Tories in Westminster have done nothing to address concerns or provide stability, the same cannot be said for this SNP government. The SNP Scottish government are providing certainty and building growth in Scotland's rural economies in these uncertain times through actions like Connect Local, the new £3 million advisory support service for food and drink sector, as well as the addition of to a £250,000 Good Food Nation Challenge Fund, a £50,000 support fund for the organic sector, and over £3 million in grants to the food and drink sector through the Food Processing and Marketing Grant Scheme. These, yes, oh, I noticed you've come back into the chamber. Yes,
Ms. Hamilton.
Watching, Mr. Lyle. NFU Scotland is calling upon the Scottish Government to confirm...
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Sorry, Mr. Lyle, through the chair, if you don't mind.
My apologies.
NFU Scotland is calling upon the Scottish Government to confirm the continuation of committed spend for the less favoured area support scheme, 70% of which is funded by Scottish Government. Does Mr. Lyle believe that that creates uncertainty within the agricultural community?
Mr. Lyle.
These actions are in addition to our work in investing in infrastructure to support rural economy growth, investment through a capital investment programme, and as highlighted in the Chamber last week, and ambitious goals for broadband, with the Scottish Government making a commitment to deliver 100% superfast broadband across Scotland by 2021. An ambition which is on track, with the Scottish Government hitting their target of 85% 6 months ahead of the schedule. The SNP will continue to provide stability, support these uncertain times, which brings me to my final area in my remarks, Presiding Officer, and that is the sorry state that the Scottish Tories are in with their newfound desire to be Brexiteers. It's clear that the Tories have performed a U-turn over Brexit. Before the referendum vote, they made grave warnings over leaving the EU. Now it's the latest of what they're calling on the SNP to make Brexit work. Presiding Officer, it is clear that we in these benches will continue to be committed to protecting Scotland's place in the EU, for our rural economy, for all our country, and to continue to play our part as an outward-looking and active nation in the European community. Since the 1st of January 1973, the EU has continually been the Tory party's Achilles heel. In fact, over the decades, the EU has totally occupied the Tory grandees. Edward Heath, Margaret Thatcher, and John Major all had their problems with the EU. David Cameron finally threw in the towel. And I agree with Mr. Kelly, must be the first time ever, by promising a referendum to head off UKIP. I'm sure Mr. Cameron now regrets what he did. He paid the ultimate price. It allowed the anti-EU Tories out of their box. They have cast us down the long road of Brexit. I, for one, will not forget what they have done to
Scotland.
The member said
his last minute.
I will never forget nor forgive, and I'm sure neither will the Scottish people when the reality sinks in.
Thank you. We now move to closing speeches. Call Rhoda Grant to close for Labour. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's a phrase, there are none so fervent as the recently converted, and that, to my mind, sums up the Tories' contribution to this debate, because it seems to me a leap of faith to go from campaigning to Remain to embracing Brexit. James Kelly made the point that we're in this position for party political expediency rather than what's good for our country. However, we must all seek to try and mitigate its effects as much as we can.
Mr. Kerr.
Would the member not agree with me that rather than being converted Brexiteers, as we've been suggested, are we not just providing a voice for the 1 million people that actually did vote for us to come out of the EU?
Ms. Grant.
What I don't understand is how you're speaking for them today but didn't agree with them several short months ago. And it seems quite strange that you can move your position so dramatically in such a short space of time. My colleague Lewis Donald made, I think, a really good contribution today. He was laying out the options that we faced and raised a number of questions, some about fishing and farming, their access to markets in Europe, but not access to payments, and whether or not they would have access to those markets without tariffs. That's something we need to try and find out answers to as we look at our farming and fishing industries that are dependent on European trade going forward. We also need to look at the payments we will be required to make to the EU if we are to access the single market. And that will tell us what the balance of payments we will have left as a country to distribute to people like our farmers for cap payments. All those things need answers. They're very important questions, but we are struggling to come to terms with them. We also need to set out priorities for what, if any, dividends will be available to us financially. Leave campaigners made the point that any dividend from leaving the EU would go to the NHS. And we know that health is dependent on much more than the NHS. It's dependent on diet, it's dependent on access of services. So to send all the money that would have gone to our farmers and our rural communities directly to the NHS would actually place a greater burden on the NHS and create more problems than it solves. And I guess to that extent, I agree with Mike Rumbles, because we do need to plan. We do need to set our priorities, given the timescales we face. And that's very difficult to do, because as we talk about this subject, and a number of people have raised different issues in different organisations that benefit from European funding, how do we unpick it all, and then how do we put it back together in a way that mitigates the impact on our rural communities? With both farming and fishing, we stand to lose access to the European markets, and we know that our shellfish, and indeed our lamb, the bulk of their market is in Europe. So we need to see how we can protect their interests and those trading partnerships. Both these industries also are dependent on migrant workers. James Kelly mentioned 5,000 to 15,000 people as migrant workers in those areas. Berry pickers are crucial to the farming industry. And some of those jobs are very seasonal, where we cannot employ people year-round, so we're dependent on people travelling across Europe, doing different harvests in different countries. We also know that Eastern European workers are the backbone of our fish processing industry, and again, we want to keep them where they are, providing for our local economy. And John Finney also mentioned what we hadn't talked about before, jobs in health and the care sectors, which are also dependent on European workers coming in. And indeed, the GP shortages that we've been talking about most recently, many European GPs are coming to Scotland to provide care for our citizens there. We need to provide certainty to our European migrants who have made their lives in this country and who have put their roots down there. We need to provide them with certainty that they can stay. But we also have to provide Scottish people working in Europe with the same certainty that they're not going to be disrupted by this. In rural Scotland, the population is a number one threat to our local economies. We need to look at ways of repopulating our rural areas and keeping our young people, and we can't do that if we're turning away those that have come to live there. We also need to collaborate with our European neighbours, and this is something that's been very successful. Gail Ross mentioned North Highland College and UHI, which have benefited from that funding. Things like the Northern Periphery projects, which shared knowledge with similar with countries with similar rural areas and similar challenges to face. And they have a lot more in common, indeed, than urban areas within their own country, a point made by Finlay Carson when he was talking about a South of Scotland enterprise that would deal with rural issues there. A number of members picked up the issue of broadband, and I'm really pleased about that, because I think this is crucial. Broadband is crucial to the rural economy and indeed the way we deliver services. We stand to lose funding from Europe. We've already benefited from that. But we also stand to lose the focus on a level playing field that Europe provides to us. And we need to see how we can replicate that. We will lose the knowledge that partnerships that we could form with other European countries facing similar geographical disadvantage and difficulties in getting connectivity out to the more rural areas. So we need to see how we can still forge ahead and make those partnerships work, so that at least if we miss out on the funding, we don't miss out from the knowledge that they can bring us. A number of people mentioned PGI status. I think Emma Harper went into some detail on this, and that wasn't difficult to obtain. I was involved in the campaign for PGI for Stornoway Black Pudding. It took years to attain, and it actually protected that product throughout Europe. We need to find ways of protecting especially the foodstuffs that have become so iconic to us, because if we're out of Europe, that protection will fall. Presiding officer, I can see that you're trying to catch my eye and speed me up slightly, so I will.
Thank you.
So I will draw to a close simply by stating that the Scottish Labour Party will always pursue what's in the best interests of Scotland. With Brexit, this is inextricably linked to what is the best outcome for the rest of the UK, and it means that our governments have to work collaboratively for all our benefits. This is not where we wanted to be, but we must seek to protect the interests of our people.
Thank you. I call on Jamie Green to wind up the Conservative Party. 9 minutes, please, Mr. Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. We welcome this debate on the Scottish rural economy and Brexit. Indeed, it's good to see that some parties are not afraid to have a debate on Brexit. But believe it or not, not everyone who lives in rural Scotland, not everyone who lives in rural Scotland is a farmer, or a fisherman, or a forester. Many are, of course, but our perception of what rural Scotland is often clouded by the funds, grants, subsidies and quotas which often dominate the discussion. And rightfully so. And much has been said about that today. Now, the Cabinet Secretary talks about his worries on future access to a single market in the EU, whilst his party campaigns to leave Scotland's biggest trading union, the United Kingdom, which is worth four times more. The Cabinet Secretary talks about future LFAS payments, but failed to mention in his speech about the £10 million of LFAS payments which are outstanding from this year. Richard Lockhead made a very pertinent point, and that is that we do have to listen to the reasons why so many sections of our rural economy voted to leave the EU. We do have to have a look at the CAP system, and as my colleague Peter Chapman said, there is the potential to design a scheme which rewards farmers, not impoverishes them. Now, the Scottish Government have a bit of a cheek today to come to this chamber and call a debate on the rural economy post-Brexit, when it has failed our farmers so dismally pre-Brexit for the last 9 years. But don't just take my word for it, let's look at the facts. A common agricultural policy IT system, which so far is 160% over budget. CAP payments which are months late, with full payments yet to be received, and almost half of Scottish farmers are failing to make enough money to pay themselves the minimum wage. Farm business income is at the lowest levels in 6 years. This is a Scottish Government which took 18 months to fill the position of Chief Scientific Advisor. A Land Reform Act which undermines property rights. Presiding Officer, we are indeed in uncharted waters. There is no doubt about that. We should remember that we are, however, having a debate about something which hasn't happened yet, about negotiations which haven't started yet. We do not know which words will form the Act which repeals, retains, or reinvents the many thousands of laws, rules, and regulations with which the EU governs. We have no crystal. I shall.
Mr. Stevenson.
Given the indication that this will all operate via the royal prerogative, is he now announcing that the Westminster Parliament will actually have a debate and a say in what's happening on Brexit?
Mr. Green.
I think the Westminster government is doing the right thing by exploring all options, and all options will be considered, which is why I said that some laws may be repealed, retained or reinvented. It's the right thing to do in this situation. We have no crystal ball here today, Mr. Stevenson. The purpose of a debate such as the one we're having should be about laying ideas on the table. If the Scottish Government seriously wishes to have a positive debate about the future of rural Scotland, then I applaud it. However, if its purpose is to engineer a scenario whereby they decide that independence is the only and inevitable solution, then I fear they are missing the point completely of any upside which Brexit might present. The underlying tone of the government's motion today is one which is not open to idea sharing, and given that 38% of Scots voted to leave the EU, I do not think, therefore, is representative of Scotland or accepts the democratic will of the people of the UK. I shall.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm grateful for giving way. Could I just ask one simple question? Do the Scottish Tories believe that EU citizens living and working in Scotland are welcome here and should continue to be welcome here and be permitted to stay here?
Mr. Green.
I haven't heard anyone say that people in Scotland are required to leave. No one has said that. Has anyone heard anyone say that? No. I absolutely think that people who have come to make Scotland their home make a valuable contribution to Scotland, and I welcome that. Now, Emma Harper talks about Tory Brexit. We've heard that word used a lot in the last hour or so. She may be surprised to learn that there aren't 17.4 million Tory voters in the UK, last time I checked. Indeed, polls suggest that about a third of SNP voters backed Leave. Are they now Tories too? Yeah. Instead of finger-wagging at Westminster, we, the Scottish Conservatives, have set up our own advisory group to look at the risks and opportunities of Brexit. A frank, informed discussion. And it counts expertise. It counts expertise such as Gavin Hewitt, former chief exec of Scotch Whisky, and Sir Ian McMillan, former director of CBI, amongst its membership. Much has been said in this chamber today about fisheries. Now let us remind ourselves of the three key asks of the SFF. That Brexit provides the opportunity to, one, the power to establish a more effective and reactive fisheries management system in our waters. Two, fairer and more appropriate shares of catching opportunities for the industry in our waters. And three, identifies opportunities which includes the freedom to explore new markets for seafood. Now, Mr. Stevenson raised some valid points, and that our two governments have to have a complex discussion on the future of fishing in the UK to get a deal that works for fishermen on both sides of the border. But the rural economy is about much more than agriculture. It is about connectivity in all its forms. Roads, rail, ferries, internet access. Rhoda Grant makes an important point about rural broadband. It is not a luxury, it is a necessity. But the rural economy is also about how we manage our land, environment, biodiversity, energy, uplands, and flood prevention. Mike Grumbles is right. Where is the vision on this? Where is the forward planning going on in the Scottish Government on Brexit? I'd like to conclude my speech by saying that unlike the Scottish Government, we don't want Brexit to fail. We instead come to this debate with ideas on the rural economy. The Government's motion today fails to take responsibility for its actions over the last 9 years in government. Unlike the Scottish Government, we have ideas on the rural economy, and let me share some. To give planning exemptions to allow retiring farmers or new entrants to build a home on agricultural land. Opening the Scottish Land Fund to long leases. Investing an additional £5 million every year to the Community Broadband Scotland scheme. Supporting a safe expansion of aquaculture. Establishing new national parks. Our amendment respects the democratic result of the UK. And I think it is time that the Scottish Government gets on with making a success of that result for the whole of rural Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on Michael Russell to close for the Government. Minister, you till about 4:59, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Chamber and at least some members for their contributions this afternoon. As I made clear in the debate last week, protecting Scotland's relationship with and place in the European Union and all its economic and social benefits is the government's explicit priority. And the idea of these debates is to look to get ideas and thinking about how we take this issue forward. And that's one of the reasons why I intend to contribute to all of them. But those ideas, if I can say to Jamie Green at the start, have to be things that require Brexit to happen. Not one of the things that Jamie Green listed requires Brexit to happen. And that is rather revealing about the nature of the contributions we've had from the Tories, the Tory myths, which I shall come back to later. I can't think of another portfolio which is more heavily entwined with the EU than this one, whether we're talking farming, forestry, fisheries, or food. EU membership delivers significant economic and social benefits to Scotland's rural and coastal communities. And I know that because I represent one of the most rural of those communities. Scotland leaving the EU as a result of the outcome of the referendum will put at risk rural jobs, investments, exports, businesses, projects and services, just as predicted by a succession of Tory spokespeople during the referendum. And the rural economy is crucial to driving forward the economy as a whole, just as the role of the EU in rural communities is deep-rooted and mutually beneficial. And we've known that for the entire 40 years that we've been members of the EU. And most importantly, and I was struck this afternoon in supporting Fergus Ewing in this debate, we've known that at a crucial time in our rural history, when in 1992, after years of effort, Madam Ikos, Fergus's mother, Winnie Ewing, secured Objective 1 status for the Highlands and Islands. And in 5 years, between 1994 and 1999, £241 million came to the Highlands and Islands, present-day values almost £1 billion. And she knew that that investment was crucial for the future of rural Scotland, just as MEPs after her knew that, just as MSPs here know that. And it seems very strange that the Tories now take a very different position, a very destructive position, because Objective 1 used facts to drive forward vision. And the Tories this afternoon have used myths to hide their lack of vision. They may laugh, but I'll give you four reasons why that's so. And the first of the one is the myth that farming is, in some sense, in crisis and disaster because of the actions of this government. That is not true. Of course, there are always problems in farming, and there are always problems in the rural economy, but that has progressed steadily since this government came to power. Secondly, the fact that fishing, the myth that fishing is guaranteed prosperity by Brexit. No, the people who regarded fishing as expendable throughout the whole process of EU negotiation were the Tories. And now the fishing community will see that they will be regarded as expendable by the Tories again. Thirdly, the myth that the Tories speak for rural Scotland. Well, I wonder if they've looked at the opinion polls lately. The SNP at 50%, the Tories at 21%, less than Margaret Thatcher got in Scotland. And finally, the myth that Brexit is full of promise. Where's the beef? Where's the evidence? Where are the facts? And I think it is shocking that instead of working with rural communities to consider and address the issues, they want to bluff and bluster in the Micawber-like hope that something will turn up, ignoring the damage that's being done now. Because the right approach, the approach urged upon me when I took this post by the Tories, were to take a practical, careful consideration of the facts. And here's some facts. The loss of non-guaranteed funds, CAP Pillar 2, 320 million, EMFF, 58 million, structural funds, 400 million. That accounts to £778 million. Please, Mr. Lockhart.
Thank you. Thank you very much for taking the intervention. Does Mr. Russell not see the irony of the SNP expressing grave concern about leaving a union with Europe that supports Scotland to the tune of up millions of pounds, while at the same time campaigning to leave the union with the rest of the UK that supports Scotland currently to the tune of £15 billion?
Minister.
I think that I disagree with the latter part of your premise so greatly, there will be no meeting of minds on that. I'm happy to give you a lesson in constitutional theory should you want one, but the reality is that the EU support for Scotland was crucial, and indeed, those people who argued against independence claimed that the only way we could stay in the EU was by voting no. Please.
You just said that the EU is crucial to the well-being of Scotland. Do you recognise that being part of the UK is also crucial to the well-being of Scotland in that we have a £1,600 per person bonus because we are part of the UK?
No, I don't recognise the bonus,
Minister.
But you know, I'm open and inclusive. I want to make sure that we deal and trade with the whole world, and I want to deal and trade with the UK and with Europe. I don't want to be cut off from Europe, which is exactly what the Tories are telling us to do. Now, the Tories could be part of the careful consideration of alternatives, looking at possible solutions and making sure that we are understanding what's taking place. They could be part of that. But for the third debate in a row, they have walked away from that. And I do hope, before we get to next week's debate, they will begin to think about how they could contribute to ideas rather than simply be slavishly loyal to their masters in London who do not know where they are going and do not know what is happening. Now, I want to comment on a couple of things within the debate that are important. The first is the contribution from Lewis MacDonald, who asked for some specific responses. I think he made some interesting and vital points about EEA countries outside CAP and CFP. It is not impossible to do that, of course, but the reality is that we need the four freedoms in order, for example, to staff a whole range of activities within our rural sector. So we're not in precisely the same position as those countries, but it is worth having that debate. And this is what these debates are about, and bringing those ideas to the table and discussing them is very important. Equally, Pillar 2 funding is vital for some of our rural development. And if we cannot have Pillar 2 funding, then we are going to be lacking an important component in what we are trying to do. Of course.
Mr. MacDonald.
I'm very grateful, given the comments he's just made around the options that might lie before us. What is it when he is talking to UK ministers about continued access to the single market? What is it if it's not the model of the European Economic Area that he is putting on the table to discuss?
Minister?
There is no table. Therefore, I'm not putting anything on the table to discuss. Those discussions and negotiations have not yet started. The Tories are laughing at that. They could encourage their colleagues in London to start the discussions tomorrow. Yeah. I'm ready, but they don't appear to be. But the reality is, when we have that discussion, then, of course, there will be issues to put on the table. And those have to include the type of things which you are raising. Now, other contributions today were very important, too. I thought the contribution from Gail Ross struck home, and it certainly struck home with me, because I represent a constituency in which we have the SAMS, the Scottish Association for Marine Science. They're facing, too, a cut of over 30% in their research income. And the reality is that in rural and Highland Scotland, those type of jobs are absolutely vital, and for them to be cut out is a real problem. Now, we have a number of other contributions which I'd like to have time to go through, but I don't really have it. Dean Lockhart, I will mention, because he kept talking about the issues to do with food. And he said there'd been no assessment of the food policy, and the food policy was a disaster. And when he was challenged on it being a disaster, said it was a real disaster, but he couldn't explain why. Here's some facts on the food policy. Turnover up 24%, now 14 billion. This is since 2008, the year in which you quoted. Exports up 39%, now valued at 5 billion. Sector growing at twice the rate of the UK sector. Retail sales of Scottish food and drink brands are up 38%. 4.8 million support from the public sector support food and drink export plan, 47 million funding for 170 projects through our food processing grant schedule. You could have looked all those things up. No, one moment, I've got some more to finish with. However, Mr. Kelly raised some interesting points on food and drink too, which you didn't raise. The food sector is very concerned about the lack of certainty from the UK government. It's estimated that 30% of the sector are EU nationals. And as well as the current workforce, the sector is very concerned about future immigration policy. You could have looked that up as well. And Mr. Whittle, finally, could have looked up a few things about food too. 41% increase in Scottish produce served across the public sector since 2007. Over 70% of suppliers are Scottish since 2013. 200% rise in the level of Scottish beef served in school, and a manifesto commitment from the SNP, and that is readily available, to do more. Now, those are just some examples of facts which could have contributed to this debate. But alas, although we had facts even from Mike Rumble, so I disagreed with the facts, at least we had an effort to contribute facts, and we had facts from the Labour benches, we had none from the Tory benches at all. So I do make a genuine appeal to the Tories as they come to consider this. If as the front bench wants us to be serious about the prospects for Scotland, if we want to encourage Scottish businesses and industries to do well, then the first thing we do is we get the facts. We go out and look for the facts. We don't simply, Mr. Whittle.
Mr. Whittle.
Let the Minister know that I spent the whole summer with Freedom of Information across the whole of the education system and across the whole of the hospital trusts, and the facts I put on the table are absolute and accurate. So just standing there and telling me that you have facts doesn't make them true.
Minister.
Well, you don't actually seem... Maybe you just... We don't actually have those, but never mind. The reality is you don't seem to like the facts that go against your preconceived notions. He doesn't seem to like the facts that say Scottish Government policy is working and working well. So I don't think Mr Whittle should be so selective with his facts. He should spend less time on FOI and more time trying to find out the truth. Now, finally, let me say this. I want every part of this chamber to try and contribute to the case that we've got to build in Scotland. And we have a hard job to build that case. And debate after debate in this chamber, we're trying to open up and explore the issues that we were required to take into negotiation. So I would benefit from the Tory party if it were to come to this table and actually give some facts and some thoughts. What we won't benefit from is the bluff and bluster, as I've said here, the Micawber-like hope that something will turn up. No, not even you, Mr. Lockhart, are going to turn up on this occasion. Something will turn up. That's not the basis for a policy. That is the basis for defending those people who have got us into this mess in the first place. The colleagues of the Tories in London who have made this mess. The Tories should help us to clear it up. So far, they're not even trying.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes this afternoon's debate. We now move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion number 1645 in the name of Claire Adamson on standing order rule changes, mandatory committee remit. And I call on Claire Adamson to speak to and to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee is proposing a set of rule changes relating to mandatory committee remits. On the 13th of June this year, the Presiding Officer wrote on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to the committee about the establishment of committees. The Parliamentary Bureau expressed its wish to establish a committee structure which remits reflecting Cabinet Secretary portfolios. It stated that it was committed to the subject matter covered by the current remits of the mandatory committees as set out in standing orders, but wished the remits of a number of them to be expanded. The Bureau proposed that the remit for the Finance Committee should be expanded to include constitutional matters. The remit of European and External Affairs Committee should be expanded to include culture and tourism. And the Public Audit Committee remit should be expanded to include post-legislative scrutiny. And the Equal Opportunities Committee remit should be expanded to include human rights. The remits of other mandatory committees would remain unchanged. The SPPA committee proposed rule changes that will allow the Parliament, on a motion of Parliamentary Bureau, to make these changes in response to a request from the Equal Opportunities Committee. We also propose that its name be changed from Equal Opportunities to Equalities. Finally, we propose an extension to the remit of Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee in order to allow it to play a role in the implementation of the Lobbying Scotland Act 2016 and to ensure that the Parliament's statutory responsibilities under that Act are met. I am pleased to move motion S5M01645 in my name.
Thank you, Claire Adamson. That question will be put at decision time, to which we now come, and there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And I wish to remind members that if the amendment in the name of Peter Chapman is successful, then the amendment in the name of Rhoda Grant falls. The first question is that Amendment 1669.2 in the name of Peter Chapman, which seeks to amend Motion 1669 in the name of Fergus Ewing on securing the interests of Scotland's rural economy, is agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. Parliament will therefore vote, and members may move. And members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on the amendment in Peter Chapman's name is as follows. Yes, 31. No, 87. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 1669.1 in the name of Rhoda Grant be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. Parliament will vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote is as follows. Yes, 83. No, 35. There were no abstentions. The amendment in the name of Rhoda Grant is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 1669 in the name of Fergus Ewing as amended be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote and members should cast their votes now. And the result of the vote on motion 1669 in the name of Fergus Ewing is as follows. Yes, 83. No, 35. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. The next question is that motion 1645 in the name of Claire Adamson on standing order rule changes be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. That concludes decision time. We'll now move to members' business, and it'll take a few minutes for members to change their seats.